I think we're live. Hey, welcome everyone. This is the Role of Play, and this is the University Libraries at Virginia Tech's bi-weekly tabletop role-playing game show. Today we are playing a cipher system one-shot based on Isaac Asimov and, wow, my brain just quit.
Silverberg.
Thank you. Isaac Asimov and Robert Silverberg's novel, Nightfall, which itself was based on a short story by Isaac Asimov. I'm Anthony Wright Day Hernandez. I am going to be the GM tonight. I am the Community Collections Archivist at Virginia Tech. So I work in Special Collections and University Archives. I can be seen here weekly on Wednesdays at twitch.tv/VTULStudios, running a show called Archival Adventures, where I share things from the archives live on stream, and so you're all welcome to stop by at 2:30 p.m. on Wednesdays for that show. But tonight, we are doing a tabletop role-playing game, and so I just will say, viewers, please remember to be kind and courteous to each other and the players in the chat. We'll talk a little bit at the end about upcoming streams, because there are some good ones coming up. I want to say, oh, what did I see? The Hobbit and more Sherlock Holmes are on their way. But how about we go ahead and do some player introductions, and you all will do character introductions when I cue you to do so after we start. So just player introductions now, and you will introduce your characters when I give you that cue. You'll know when. So let's start with Malaka.
Hi, my name is Malaka. I graduate student. Also a third year PhD student in the very long name Communication Rhetoric and Digital.
All right. How about Lara?
Hi, everyone. I'm Lara Fountaine. I'm the Student Success and Engagement Librarian at NC State University.
And Shaun.
Hey, I'm Shaun Bennett. I'm the Research Librarian for Business, Education, and Data Literacy at the NC State University Libraries. And this is Wee Baby Atticus, who will be joining us as well.
Love that name.
Welcome both.
Literary name.
Last but not least is Jonathan, who makes the entire Twitch stream possible for us.
Yeah, one of these days people are going to get tired of seeing me. I am Jonathan Bradley. I'm head of studios and innovative technologies for the University Libraries at Virginia Tech. I use he, him pronouns, and I'm here all the time, basically. We got it. We're vamping for audio stuff.
Yeah, our producer is working on fixing that audio issue. We had a horrible echo, so one moment.
What was the release time? One more time. How's that?
Hopefully that has fixed the echo. Thank you everybody for joining us tonight. And I think it's about time that we dive into this game.
Yeah.
Everybody ready?
Let's go for it.
Okay.
Yeah.
If the stars should appear one night in 1,000 years, how would men believe and adore and preserve for many generations the remembrance of the city of God? That is the quote by Ralph Waldo Emerson that inspired the novel, inspired the short story, and then later the novel. First, I'm going to relate the information that the players were given before creating their characters, and then we will do a little bit of introduction to where you are now. Welcome to Kalgash, an alien world. Kalgashian technology is roughly equivalent to that of Earth in the late 1980s. Kalgash has no cell phones, no internet, and no space program. And the people described aren't like the people that you would see on Earth, but we talk about hands and eyes and mouths. We'll talk about cars and guns and buildings as we would see them on Earth, but they are alien. And so you can imagine them however you want. Kalgash is a planet with six suns. One sun is always in the sky. Onos, the main sun, is a yellow dwarf, similar to Sol, the Earth's sun. Onos provides a warm, friendly light that cheers the inhabitants of Kalgash. Trey and Patru, smaller and dimmer than Onos, they always appear in the sky together, unless one is below the horizon while rising or setting. They provide a cool white light. Tano and Sitha, similar to Trey and Patru, they appear as a pair. They provide bluish light. And finally, Dovim, the smallest and dimmest of the suns, is a red dwarf. On the rare days when it is the only sun in the sky, inhabitants are generally subdued and unhappy. Over the past year, some important events have happened that have been noted in the press. A recent exhibition in Jonglor, a city far from Sero City, featured a ride called the Tunnel of Mystery, where riders were taken through a completely dark enclosure. The ride was eventually shut down after many riders exhibited extreme claustrophobia followed by extreme agoraphobia. An archaeologist from Sero University, Sifera 89, discovered layer upon layer of burned cities within the Hill of Thombo at the Beklamat archaeological site. Carbon dating shows that the cities burned in roughly 2,050-year intervals. Bine 25, an astronomer at Sero University, has postulated the existence of a moon, dubbed Kalgash 2, that will theoretically eclipse Dovim on a one-sun day every 2,049 years. A cult, the Apostles of Flame, has for years been claiming that the world will be destroyed in darkness with the appearance of stars that unleash a torrent of fire. The cult is largely dismissed as fanatics by the general populace. So that is what everybody had to work with as they built their characters. Now we dive in. Leading up to Theptar 19th, the news of an impending eclipse was everywhere. Mondior 71, leader of the Apostles of Flame, and his first lieutenant, Fulliman 66, made dire predictions, warning that the stars will shoot flame down out of a black sky on Theptar 19th. Scientists from Sero University, including Aethor 77 and Bine 25 from astronomy, Sifra 89 from archaeology, and Shirin 501 from psychology, warned that on Theptar 19th, a previously unknown astronomical body dubbed Kalgash 2 would eclipse Dovim on a rare Dovim-only day, leading to periods of darkness of 9 to 14 hours worldwide. While they dismissed the idea of stars, they did warn that the psychological impact of the darkness would cause people mental distress and lead people to light fires to bring back light. Theramon 762, the newspaperman, wrote many articles warning against believing either group. He appealed to people's common sense and claimed that the scientists at the university had clearly been deceived in some way by the dangerous cult, the Apostles of Flame. Then, Theptar 19th arrived. The other suns set, giving a glorious five-sun day to part of the world, and leaving Sero City with a dreary Dovim-only day. As the day progressed, a chip disappeared from Dovim, and slowly the sun was swallowed. It grew gradually darker. People began to riot and panic. They lit fires against the coming darkness. They rushed to the Sero University Observatory or toward the Apostles of Flame compound. Once Dovim was completely engulfed by darkness, something new appeared in the sky. Stars. So many stars. Thousands of stars stabbing down from the sky, grouped in clusters, filling the sky as far as one could see. Stars were dazzling. People who had known for thousands of years that their planet and its six suns were the entire universe were suddenly confronted with the reality of a vast cosmos and their insignificance within it. They reacted in various ways. Some were frozen and unable to act. Some became violent. Some ran and hid. Some sought the comfort of familiar kinds of light, and the fires that had been lit against the darkness began to spread. All of you were affected by the sight of the stars. You came back to yourselves after a time of disassociation, unsure exactly how much time had passed. Onos was in the sky, and you found yourselves in a city in ruins. After a time, you found each other, and having some passing familiarity with each other, have banded together to survive. You are in a section of Sero City near the university shelter. You have been surrounded by a group of people wearing bright green neckerchiefs. They have weapons trained on you. A man steps forward and speaks. He's roughly 50, a strong, commanding figure, poised and confident. His clothing looks expensive, and his neckerchief has the sheen of silk. Who are you?
Let's go first.
I'll go first. I am Shireen 96.
Go ahead and describe yourself too.
So I am a private investigator working as a private investigator. I used to go to Sero University, and was training to become a detective, but I decided that I was too good for that. And so I decided to become a private investigator, and here I am. And yeah, I don't really work well in teams, so I'm just gonna hang out.
His gaze shifts to Nim.
I'm Nim, 28. I worked at Sero University as an advisor for the students. But you know how all the systems are. You just sometimes gotta stick it to the. I'm always on the side of my first and foremost, like that. I'm not sure exactly what's going on here.
And gaze shifts to Lena.
Yes, good sir. I am Lena 42. I'm tenured faculty here at Sarah's University. I don't know that the guns are really needed in our current circumstances. I do have a few questions that I would like to ask you about your current experiences. I think these need to be documented immediately. This is a once-in-a-lifetime research opportunity. As a meta description, Lena is a professor, a scholar, a field researcher. She looks a little frazzled, and is not necessarily respected at Sero's University anymore because she has a lot of fringe theories about what darkness is, and all of this has confirmed all of her biases.
And finally, he looks over to El-Cid.
I'm El-Cid 23. I'm muscle for hire around here. I keep these folks safe, and I agree. There's no need for guns. You can tell they're really not much of a threat, and I don't plan on starting anything today. For Meta, he is he's been muscle for hire for years in various locations, and finally started acting as a bodyguard for university folks who are going into dangerous locations, though it's normally more wildlife rather than large groups of men with guns.
He looks you over very slowly, eyeing you all up and down. And then he says, "Are you carrying any combustible? Matches, lighter, pocket generator, anything you could use to start a fire?"
Why would we want to start a fire? Well, I have a few questions for you as well, good sir. So right now,
we have to find out whether you have fire-making materials on you. Strip. All of you.
Well, that's very forward of you, sir.
Article 1. Fire starting is prohibited. Article 2. Fire patrol may take any action deemed necessary to prevent unauthorized fire starting. Strip.
Are you the fire patrol?
Strip. Show us you have no fire-making materials on you.
Now, we don't have to get mean, but we definitely can. We don't have anything on us. No intention of starting fires. We're
Prove
academics.
It. Prove it.
I go...
I have nothing.
I take a lighter out, and I go, I have this. Do you want this?
He nods, and one of his... one of the group of people surrounding you comes over and takes it out of your hand. What else have you got?
I've got like notebook. She's like, I've got my notes. I've got this pen, which I want to ask you some questions. I've got, let's see, I've got a pocket knife over here. I've got some rope. Let's see, what else do I got? Just, like pulling stuff out of her coat. I got a compass. My keys to my vehicle. Wait, what is this for? Who are you?
Article 3. This may include immediate summary execution of those who resist fire patrol authority. Strip, show us you don't have any fire-making materials on you. They've got guns especially trained on you, Lena, because you had fire-making material.
Okay, I strip.
My coat.
All right, fine.
I'm going to just sigh audibly and be like, why not?
Yeah, this is very not in accordance with those contract that I've signed with the university. And give him my like lab coat / robe, like fancy like field research robes.
Okay, but you don't strip all the way down?
I probably have like a button-down shirt, and I would probably like open that button. But most all of my belongings are in my like my coat that's carrying all my junk.
He motions, and two of his guards come over and pat you down, mm-hmm. since you didn't remove your clothing entirely. They take a moment. They look through the articles that you've taken off. They take away anything that could be used for starting fires. They don't immediately remove the guns, but any lighters, anything, batteries, matches, anything like that, they remove.
And they take paper.
They're not concerned with paper. They're concerned with the things that would be used to actually light the fire. The man says, all right, get dressed. They haven't been ogling you. None of the guards have been particularly like lascivious in their looks. And so the man is saying, we're the fire patrol. We are here to bring order back to this part of Cerro City. That starts by preventing people from burning the rest of it down. No one in this part of the city is allowed to start a fire except us. You cannot have fire-making abilities. We will start a fire to cook food, or to keep some people warm. But you've seen.
Yeah,
there's a lot
of fires.
The darkness came. The fires mm-hmm. were lit.
It finally emerged from its hidey hole. Yes.
There are still people out in this city running around without command of their faculty. Lighting fires because they enjoyed the chaos of that night, or simply going around murdering people. We intend to bring order back to this city.
So I can't start a fire to keep myself warm or to cook my own food?
Well, that depends. You all seem coherent enough. Would you...
Thank you.
If you are willing to work to bring this city back to order, you could always join the fire patrol. But you are, I think some of you mentioned that you are associated with the university.
Yes, I'm going to be writing a strongly worded letter to the Faculty Senate after all of this.
I think you'll find there is no such body.
Aw.
Does this mean my union's not covered either?
Have you not realized that all of society has collapsed?
Well, I've been a little...
taking a lot of... Yeah. Go ahead.
We've been a little sequestered off, if you know what I mean.
I've been taking a lot of notes.
Basically, everyone was incoherent for a few days. It's good to see that you've recovered yourselves.
I never went incoherent. That's just not how I am.
I think incoherency is just a byproduct of actually being in the creature known as darkness.
I've been perfectly sane this whole time.
Well, then you must have seen some horrors.
Oh, yeah. I'm used to that, though.
As I said, since you all seem relatively coherent, we can always use additional guards here to help us protect this part of the city and bring back order. This, I believe, was the university shelter where all of you university types were taking refuge during the nightfall.
Question, sir. If I join your patrol, can I question people about their experiences during the nightfall?
I don't see why not, as long as you're taking fire-making equipment from them and keeping the peace.
Yeah, sure. Could do that.
As I was saying, this was the university shelter. All of your university associates have moved on long since. I believe that they were headed to Amgondo National Park to try and, I don't know, set up some sort of government. So if you prefer their company, that would be where you head. Otherwise, you work for me.
Well, I don't work for anyone, so bye.
Would I have to work on tenure if I switch to your side? Because I already have tenure with them.
You start at the bottom.
Ah.
Ugh.
I don't know, I might be with...
You're not making this sound very appealing.
I don't care.
I don't even know where you came from.
I'm in charge of this part of the city.
Where did you come from?
I am the order
in
this place.
Who says you're in charge?
Fire Patrol does. We're the ones with the guns.
I have a gun, too.
That can be changed. There are about 16 of them around you.
I'm calculating.
Many people do I have to shoot?
Does anybody else have guns?
Not that many.
I carry a sawed-off shotgun.
I got a baby, like, pew-pew shooter.
Dang. All right, well.
So, essentially, you have two options before you. You can stay here and join up with the fire patrol as the lowest rung on the ladder, or you can try and seek out the university folk who headed off to Amgondo National Park, or, you know, honestly, you can take things extremely off the rails and decide something else, and I will roll with it.
I go, I don't know about the rest of y'all, but I don't like the idea of not having tenure with this group of people.
I can't imagine living without tenure, how terrible that would be.
I mean, whatever the equivalent of tenure is for a bodyguard, I mean, you'd have to work your way back up to that. You were very well respected. I mean, granted, my colleagues didn't like me very much, but...
Neither did the students.
No. Well, the students didn't mind. They always said my classes were pretty easy. Mostly because I didn't show up for them.
That's kind of the impression I was given.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair.
Well, I need to get to the bottom of this, so, I mean, I'm not going to blindly follow the fire patrol. I want to talk to some folks from the university, because I don't exactly believe everything that you're saying. So, bye.
Take care of my lighter.
All right.
Get a receipt for that, by the way?
You do not.
Okay.
I will, so however,
ask for your name later.
My name, if you didn't recognize me, is Altanol 111.
Okay. Got it. And she writes that down.
And I am the law in this part of Sarah City.
Okay.
If you all are willing to sweep the city as you head out, I will give you permission to wear our colors, gestures to the green neckerchief, which will help speed you along your way. Most of the rabble around here respect fire patrol.
Why would you do that?
I'm not an unreasonable man. I just believe in order. There are people out here running wild. I'm bringing order to this place. My methods may seem brutal to you, but they have become necessary in the current circumstance.
I mean, what does sweeping the area entail? Can I ask people questions on the way?
I don't care about that.
Okay. Sure, I'm in then.
If you're serving fire patrol on your way across the city, that will mean preventing people from starting fires and burning this city down.
Okay.
That will be the expectation. If you violate it, we will come after you.
Okay.
And if we don't agree to that?
If you don't agree, you're on your own. You don't get to wear the colors. You don't get that extra protection.
So, am I supposed to shoot people who are starting fires? I'm a little unclear on the methodology here. Y'all were really gun-pointy when you arrived.
Don't point a gun if you're not willing to use.
Okay, so not a clear answer then?
That's the only answer you get.
Yeah.
All right, where's my handkerchief, neckerchief, whatever?
They'll set you up with a little bit of food. And you get some nice bright green neckerchiefs. The people who, I mean, after you all agree, the guns go down. Some of the underlings come over, and they're quite nice. They're like, oh, you know, it'd be lovely if you stayed, but you know, I understand you probably have friends among the university folk, and you know, honestly, if I could travel those hundreds of miles myself to Mgando National Park, I probably would go, but there's no way I can travel that far by myself. You know, they're nice. They get you set up with green neckerchiefs and some food and point you towards that. Everything is ruined. So, you know, your orientation within the city is a little bit confuzzled. And they point you in the direction of the Great Southern Highway, which is the most direct route from Saro City to Mgando National Park. It's about 300 or 400 miles from the city, and you still have a couple of neighborhoods of the city to go through before you reach the highway.
Question. Since I'm wearing the green neckerchief, can I have my lighter back?
No.
Damn it.
We'll just steal someone else's lighter.
I was going to say, we can just confiscate somebody else's. It's fine.
I think that's what we're supposed to do.
Yeah, it's...
Well, I have a vehicle. Right. You want to... Are the roads clear enough to take a vehicle?
Let's hope so.
Generally, no. Definitely not within the city here.
Okay.
Are there horses?
You haven't seen any.
Heavy snowplows.
A bulldozer.
There we go. I haven't hotwired a bulldozer before, but I'll try.
Hey, there's a first for everything.
Where your head's at.
If you want to look for a functional piece of construction equipment, you can do so. Let's see. That's going to be an intellect roll, and I'm going to put the difficulty at 4, which means you need to hit a target of 12.
I'll give it a shot, try to look well. So, sort of the meta side of this, how can everybody roll on something like that, or does one person need to be chosen as the person who goes for it?
Somebody is going to be doing it. If somebody wants to help, that can count as an asset to reduce the difficulty. Anything that you have that might help you, any skills that you have that might help with something like this, can also be an asset. And, you know, if you really want to make it happen, you can spend up to one level of effort. So, depends on how hard you're trying to do it. So your target number is 12, and that is 1d20 to roll.
I'm not necessarily the most intellectually gifted member of our little group today, so I would be happy to be an asset for somebody else.
Who would want to lead this search?
If y'all will pull Lena 42 away, she's like interviewing all these people, and I was like, so when you were out during the nightfall, do you remember anything when you came back? Did anyone talk to you? Did you hear any voices in your head? It's like, well, wait. What? Okay.
Lena, if we get a bulldozer, we can interview more people on the way.
That's valid.
And get to other people faster.
Yeah, just take them with us.
Oh, yeah.
So
we could get a cart behind it.
Finding one.
Tow them with us.
A whole bunch of bulldozers.
Yeah, put them in the bulldozer thing.
Yeah, I'm trained in searching.
Yep. So trained in searching will count as one reduction in difficulty. Yes. The training will reduce it to difficulty 3. You're getting help, so that counts as an asset, and that will reduce it one more to difficulty 2. So that would put your target number as 6, unless you want to spend some effort to...
I think I can roll a 6. Let's go for it.
Famous last words.
16. Haha, I did it.
All right. So
a good omen.
So, yeah, you managed to find a slightly scorched piece of construction equipment that we would equate to a bulldozer that seems to have fuel cells in it and is operational. Who knows? It's run into a building. So it's possible that it was in operation when Nightfall began and that the driver just got out and left. At some point, the engine shut off. The fuel cells are still working. The keys are in the ignition. So you have a vehicle that you can use to move through the city.
See, I knew where it was at.
All right.
My friend Charles, who works construction in this area, used to drive one of these bulldozers around. I know they're working in here. Wonder where Charles is at. Hopefully not dead, but probably.
Well, if one of y'all wants to drive this thing, I'll perch on the back and keep eye, because it's going to be loud.
I jump in. I'm ready to drive.
Do you know how to operate a piece of heavy machinery?
Yes.
I am checking mine. I cannot assist you with this in any way.
I do not see in your skills anything about driving heavy machinery.
Dang it.
Which just means...
So I get in and it's clear I don't know what I'm doing.
Essentially, but that just means that it's you're gonna have to roll to like figure out if you're able to figure out how to operate it. So you all have found one. I mean, its controls are not extremely different from that of a passenger car. And most people in the world know how to operate passenger cars. So there are a few levers and buttons and controls that you're uncertain what they do. But I'm just going to set this at a difficulty 3, which is demanding. So that is a 9 that you would need to roll. And you just, if you've got anything that would help with that, it's going to be, again, an intellect, because you're trying to figure out what the controls do and get oriented to how this all operates. So yeah, the target number to hit is a 9.
I'll sit in the passenger seat and be like, no, you don't want to pull that lever. That's not the lever to pull.
So are you helping or hindering?
Helping.
Your version of helping?
Yeah,
this could be either.
I mean, I do own a vehicle. I also have navigation, although that is a slightly different task
that's a different skill.
Assumption is I would be sitting up here and to be like, go over there.
I will let you help to figure out what the controls do. So that'll drop it to just a standard difficulty, which is a 6 as the target number. Don't really see anything on your skills that jumps out at me, but if you want to make an argument for one, you're welcome to.
I'm just gonna roll.
Okay. So you need to hit a 6.
If you push that button, you want to make sure you push it twice. Never just push it once.
I got a 6.
You get it working, you figure out the controls, you're able to operate this piece of heavy machinery, and you all set out. Where are you going?
Southish?
Yeah. Headed towards
Navigator.
I have navigation.
Where are we going?
I'm headed towards this utopia for academics. This.
Okay. So heading through the city towards the on ramp to the Great Southern Highway, which will take you to Mgondo National Park.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm looking as I'm driving. I'm looking for people trying to use fire.
All right.
And I'll keep an eye out from the back for anybody who's excited about stealing a bulldozer.
many people.
It is loud. And so the city generally has been mostly quiet. I mean, there's a lot of rubble everywhere, so occasionally there's the sound of, like, rock tumbling down. You can occasionally there are still fires that are burning. There might be an occasional explosion from one of those. Generally, though, it's quiet, and the sounds that you hear are oops and hollers and screams. Basically, the sounds of people, but they sound more like animals. Also the sound of animals, because there are definitely dogs running through the city, and yeah, so there is life around. You are the loudest thing around at the moment, and you don't move terribly fast on this. You probably could walk at roughly the same pace that you're able to go with this, but having a bulldozer lets you push disabled cars and rubble out of your way. So you're able to make decent progress through the city.
We're riding along. I'm like, have you read my book?
I'm trying to drive.
What?
I'm trying to drive.
I don't see anyone out there. I think it's dogs barking.
Whatever.
So you're...
I guess I...
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
you're driving through ruined streets. You were in the area of the like university district of the city, which is sort of over on like the northwest side. So basically you have to go through kind of the downtown district and some residential districts to get to the highway. Everything is collapsed and burnt. There might be like a park that you could try and go through if you wanted to, and avoid like the taller buildings that were the center of downtown. So you've got some options as to which approach you want to take. You would know generally how to navigate the city, so but it is up to you whether you want to try to go through the central downtown district or through an adjacent park to get to the residential districts south of downtown.
I have a meta question. Mm-hmm. Is there alcohol in this universe?
There is.
Okay. So I turned to everyone and I said, okay, I think I know this really great bar around here. Obviously, it's probably closed. But I think we're going to need some booze for this trip. So I feel like we should stop and see if there's anything we can scrap.
It's weird. People always...
I agree completely.
Just drink booze whenever I'm around. I just give off vibe.
You absolutely do.
Yeah. You're the party professor.
All right. So I'm going to start heading towards my favorite bar,
okay,
which is downtown.
Sounds good. You managed to get there, no real issues on the way. So you pull this bulldozer down through some downtown streets. Occasionally you have to shift some rubble out of the way, or you know, there are cars with bodies in them that you have to shove out of the way with the bulldozer. The buildings here are just like everywhere else, they're just taller and crumbling. But you manage to get to the general vicinity of where this bar was.
Okay. So, stop the car. Get out. And start looking, walking around, seeing if I can figure out where it is or what's happened to it.
Will you get me a rum while you're in there?
Sure, I'll come back with a full load. Wait, is anyone going with me?
Oh, I'm going with you. You're not going in there by yourself.
Okay.
Can we trust you to stay with the bulldozer?
Yeah. I've never gotten downtown as quickly as this.
I know, traffic's usually a nightmare.
Yeah, traffic, when the students are here.
Upsides to the apocalypse, better traffic.
So, you can easily find the bar. Like, the streets are identifiable. Things are burnt, things are rubble, but the intersections, you can still kind of get your bearings and you manage to find the bar. It was a ground floor bar and had a glass front, and the glass has shattered. So getting in, not too difficult as long as you're careful. What do you want to do?
Okay, so I'm gonna try to like perceive if there's anything dangerous, like any wild animals in there, anybody kind of like who might hurt us or attack us or whatever.
There doesn't seem to be a lot of noise at the moment. You can definitely hear dogs in the distance, there doesn't seem to be anything in the bar itself.
All right, so I step over the glass and go in, go behind the bar and start looking for bottles.
You can definitely find a few. It looks like somebody has been here before, so it's not like the choicest stuff. This is like bottom rail liquor. You've got just
bottles of Fireball everywhere.
Yeah, I mean, there's some Goldschlager, there's a little bit of Jägermeister, but otherwise it's bottom rail.
All right, I grab like whatever's left.
Okay. Yeah, you can note that you now have, I don't know, 10 bottles of alcohol on you.
Nice.
I open one up and start drinking. So 9 bottles.
And now seems like as good a time as any to have you all find, or have you all roll for some ciphers. So ciphers are, you know, not surprisingly what this game is named, a core part of the game. Because of the setting, I'm not using manifest ciphers, which are things that you would search for and would be like devices. Instead, we're using what are called subtle ciphers, which are just going to be abilities that they're like one-use abilities. So what you're going to need to do is you're going to roll a D100. So that's can be done with 2 D10s or 1 D10 that you roll twice, whatever you've got. Also, I can roll it for you if you need me to.
76.
And just because I'm curious, how many of you have your dice in one of these little Crown Royal bags?
I have some of those.
I have never, ever touched a bottle of Crown Royal, and I have 3 of these. I think they manifest when you buy a role-playing book.
Yeah. I just heard the laughter in the background.
Is this a D10?
My wife is home.
It should look like similar to this. So this is my
It looks like a D10 to me. Yeah.
Okay.
Jonathan, you said 96.
76.
76. Okay. That is gonna be. Your cipher is called Remembering.
Not my strong suit, so that's good.
I need you to roll a D6.
Ooh. Second roll. A 5.
Okay. So this cipher, when activated, will let you recall any one experience that you have ever had. But it can be no longer than 5 minutes in length. But your recall is perfect. So the example given is if you saw somebody dial a telephone number, you would remember what the number was.
Okay.
So that is one that you will start with. And you all each have a limit of 2 ciphers, so you're going to go ahead and roll for 2 of them. So you'll need to roll again, Jonathan. We'll get these assigned and move forward, and then don't be afraid to use them. Use them as often as you want, and when it feels like a good time, I will give you more. Because they are abilities, not items. So they are just things where you're going to have a stroke of good luck, and you'll be able to do something better than you normally could. Think of the tale of a mother who has a surge of adrenaline and lifts a car off of her child. It's that type of thing where you have a sudden moment where you're able to do something unique. Malaka?
I don't know about the rest of you, but I am the kind of person that ends a video game with all the rare items still in my inventory because I might have needed them. So I will do my best.
Malaka, what did you roll?
I rolled a 42, which, I mean,
that's the answer to life, the universe, and everything.
I was about to say I was disappointed with it, and then I was like, wait a minute. So I hope it's something good.
It is called an intellect booster.
I am a very smart character, so this works.
Let me find it here. Intellect booster. Roll a D6 for me.
I have a lot of dice surrounding me. I have options of what kind I want to use. That's going to be a 2.
All right. So it is a level 4 cipher. So it adds 1 to your intellect edge for 1 hour after being activated. So I believe you already have one edge?
I do have one edge.
So you're
have two.
You would have two
for
edge in intellect for an hour after activating that. Let's see. I'm going to try and call you all by your character names. Shireen.
Yes.
What did you roll?
I rolled a 45.
45. This is called intelligence enhancement. All right. So all of your tasks involving intelligent deduction, such as playing chess, inferring a connection between clues, solving a mathematical problem, finding a bug in computer code, and so on, are eased by two steps for 1 hour. And then the hour after that, the strain of the enhancement will hinder your tasks by two steps. So once you activate it, those types of tasks are eased for an hour and then hindered for an hour.
Okay.
Elsin.
Got a 41.
All right, that is the intellect booster again. Roll a d6.
I think it wouldn't be hard to find one of those. There we go. Six.
Six. Okay. So that is going to be a level 8 cipher. So you will add 2 to your intellect edge for 1 hour when activating it. Okay. And let's quickly go through the same round again 13. So you all get your second ciphers.
13.
13 is going to be a contingent activator. Basically, it will automatically activate another cipher under a condition that you specify. So
okay.
I don't remember what your first cipher was.
It was the remembering one.
Yeah, so you can have this automatically activate your remembering one at a given time under a certain circumstance. But yeah, that's what it does. It links to another cipher and will automatically activate it under a specific set of circumstances. It is possible to give up a cipher and get a new one at any time. You just let me know that you're going to remove one and roll for another one. So if you choose to do that, it's an option. That's all I was getting at. Let's see. Okay, so the rolls are here. Malaka, you also rolled 13. It looks like.
Yeah, I'm thinking I might want to get rid of it because I don't know how that's going to help me with my intellect.
So essentially what would happen is if you came into a situation, I'll just give an example. If you were in a situation where you were suffering intellect damage or where you were needing to boost your intellect for some reason but you were going to be incapacitated, then you could have this contingent activator automatically give you that boost. So even if you were set to fall unconscious because you were about to lose all of your intellect pool, this could give you a boost to help you resist or do. It is one of the situational ones where you kind of have to be creative to figure out exactly how you're going to use it when it's not activating a device. But yeah, that is up to you. If you don't want that one, you can discard it and roll again for something else.
Probably going to discard and roll if that's okay.
Yep, that's fine. I will come back around to you then. Shaun, it looks like you rolled a 3. That is an analeptic. Analeptic is It will restore a number of points equal to the cipher's level to your speed pool. So I need you to roll a d6.
6 again.
So that is a level 8 cipher. So it will restore up to, it will restore 8 points to your speed pool.
Okay. Cool.
And then Lara, a 12. Mm-hmm. That is also the contingent activator.
Okay. Can you explain it again?
What it can do is you can set a condition under which it will activate your other cipher.
I'll keep it.
Okay. Malaka, did you roll again?
I did. I got a 37.
All right. 37 is an enduring shield.
Ooh.
It's amazing that you all were rolling the same, like, numbers.
I have no idea how that happened.
And they're all kind of on the low side. Does this bode badly for us?
The enduring shield, once you activate it for the next day, you'll have an asset to speed defense roll.
Okay. And you said a full day it'll last?
Yes.
Wow.
So on my speed rolls, would that just be, it would allow the level to go down, or?
So if somebody is attacking you, and you're rolling to defend, mm-hmm. then, it's a speed defense roll in that case, and this would give you an asset, which would mean the difficulty of that roll is lowered by one.
That's great.
Okay. So you're all filled up on ciphers now. You've got those abilities in your pocket. You can use them whenever you want.
And booze.
And you can also get rid of them and roll for new ones anytime that you wish. But those are there. They are part of your character. You've all got booze. As you're coming out of the bar, those dogs you heard in the distance come tearing around the corner. There are dogs that are, they see you, like they spot you and they are coming at you. I've lost names, I'm sorry. Lena, you're on the bulldozer. The three of you are exiting the bar, and it's a pack of four dogs. I mean, most of them seem like they were probably pets. One of them is a bit more like a German Shepherd, like something that a pit bull, a breed that would have been like a guard dog somewhere.
Dogs are coming.
They do not look happy. They look like they are aggressive. They're growling. There's like foam coming off of their mouths from just how like they're aggressive. And they are coming for you.
Well, I like puppies, but I'm gonna unsling the rifle and fire a shot near them in the desperate hope that it scares them off.
All right. So the difficult two, let's see, that is gonna be, you're firing the gun, so I'm gonna go ahead and do a speed roll. The difficulty to see if they are frightened away. Decide how hard it is, how starved they are. I'm gonna set the difficulty at 5. They look like they have not been eating well, and they see prey in front of them. So you need to roll a 15 in order to scare them away.
Okay. And I've got a speed pool of 16, so I could use 2 of those, is that correct, to bring that down?
You can spend up to one level of effort because you are a tier one character.
Right.
So you could spend three unless you've got edge in... I don't remember what you have edge.
I do not have edge in speed, so I will go ahead and then spend 3 points from that.
All right.
I'm down to 13.
So that will bring the difficulty down to 4, which would be a 12 that you need to roll.
All right. I'll give it a shot.
Clearly.
You have special ability, though.
Oh, do I?
You are practiced with all weapons.
Hmm.
So I would count that as an asset, which would drop it to difficulty 3 and make your target a 9.
Okay. That does sound better. All right. 11.
Yay!
So you manage to scare off this pack of feral dogs. They hear the crack of that rifle, and they just start whining and turn around and run the other way. That was not the prey that they were looking for. Go ahead and mark off your ammo that you used for that.
You shouldn't shoot the dogs. They're not starting fires. They're not in our wheelhouse.
The shepherd looked like a pyro.
Is that Clayton's eye?
takes a note. Dogs? Fire? Result of darkness. Maybe. New symptom?
Oh my gosh.
Perhaps.
All right. You have made noise. People know you're around. You scared off those dogs, but probably not best to linger here.
Let's hop in our very speedy escape vehicle, which is also very stealthy.
Let's do it while we're all drinking, yes.
Yes. Load the booze in the back. Get in the driver's seat. Everybody get in. I'm assuming everybody's in.
As you're loading the booze in the vehicle, I go, it occurs to me that we could start a fire with this.
We'll just say that we confiscated it in case anyone asks.
It's not high proof enough. It's fine.
Okay.
Does anybody
alcohol
have any
alcohol is fuel for a fire, but they were only concerned with fire starting equipment. So matches, lighters, etc. Alcohol by itself won't light on fire.
Well, I mean, I think we're doing we're doing our job, you know, if anyone asks.
Oh, yeah.
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 We're drinking it, thus it cannot be used to light fires.
We found suspicious fire starting material.
Right. It was confiscated.
Yeah. All right.
Take a swig, and then I go.
All right. Drunk driving heavy machinery down through the ruined downtown district of Cerro City.
I go, normally I wouldn't condone drunk driving, but, you know, apocalypse
Shireen,
and all.
Shireen 96 manages to progress you south of downtown. You are approaching the residential district where the on-ramp to the Great Southern Highway exists. As you approach, the skyscrapers of downtown fall away, not because they were crumbling from being debris, but they just, they're in the past. They're behind you now. I realize all of those could be interpreted as ways of describing destruction, but that was not my intent. Anyway, you come upon a district that was actually a relatively affluent district before nightfall. It's a housing district. There's some parks in it. There are nice single-family homes in this neighborhood, and the houses appear to be generally intact. There doesn't seem to be a whole lot happening. There aren't, like, you don't see lights through windows. Obviously, the electricity has been out for who knows how long. You still don't know how long it has been since nightfall happened. but you don't see fires through windows either, and most of the lawns and buildings don't seem too terribly damaged. There's some soot damage here and there, some yards where it seems like a fire might have burned, but generally the houses seem okay. You do see the long strip of the Great Southern Highway rising up at the other end of the district, rising up into the air as it proceeds south. It is a raised highway. And a couple of blocks in front of you on the right, there is a little swirl of smoke rising from a house. And you can detect just the faintest hint of roasting meat on the air. That's where you're at.
Yeah, do you think they're starting fires over there, or if that's just steam? Maybe they're steaming their food.
Only one to find out.
Yeah, let's go.
Maybe they have a faster car we can borrow.
Ooh, yeah. Wait. Are there any nice cars in this neighborhood that I see?
Yeah, I mean, there are garages. There don't seem to be any cars parked out on the street. Like I said, this is a relatively affluent neighborhood, and generally everybody parked in the garage here.
All the vehicles around here have low jack on. Space low jack.
All right, I'm tempted to go to start, like, peeking through some garage, like the door, not the big door, but the side door, to see if there are cars in there. If I find a car,
I will bring my crowbar to help with this investigation.
Yes. I'm also skilled in lock picking, so.
All right. So you're gonna open up a garage.
Yes.
Can I use one of my ciphers?
Yeah.
Can I remember where a colleague of mine who lives in this area hid the key to their house?
Absolutely. You just all of a sudden you remember that. One second. You remember that Zithuz 106 lived just around the corner, and you know that they had one of those little hide-a-key rocks. Just in the garden next to their front door.
I go,
you know exactly where it is. You know where the key was located.
I go, yep. Zithuz's work was deeply flawed, but he did live in this did live in this area. So if you just want to, like, go grab his vehicle, we could probably do that. I'm sure he didn't survive.
I'm cool with
that. That sounds good.
That's fine with me. Also, your professor ratings make so much sense.
All right, so you all head over to Zithu's 106's house and find the key. It is in the hide-a-key rock.
So this is why you can't trust a scholarly work. He just put his keys to his house and it's a rock.
And with that key, you're able to open the door to this house. As you do, you open it and there's nobody inside. It is completely quiet. It is silent. The house seems to have burned in part. The front facade had looked pristine, but the back of the house is sort of broken down. There's some charring. It seems like maybe the fireplace in the living room was overfilled. And it has burned part of that house away. But that is the side of the house opposite to where the garage is located. So you proceed through and open up the garage, and there is a car there.
What kind of car?
A car that seats more than the one person that the bulldozer does. So you won't have to hang on to the sides.
Bonus already. And it'd be difficult for it to not be quieter. So...
A lot faster.
I'm gonna open up the main garage door and grab the booze from the bulldozer because I want to put it in the trunk. Well, okay, in the back seat.
I'm just like looking through Zithuz's like library while they're doing all this, and I'm like, this book's not any good.
Ooh. Oh. Can I look around the garage to see if there looks any?
Sure. Go ahead and do an intelligence roll for me, just to see what you might find. This is just going to be a fairly standard difficulty. Okay. So I'm going to put the difficulty at 1, so you just have a target number of 3. It's an unfamiliar place, but looking around somebody's garage to find tools is not a difficult thing to do. It's fairly routine.
Perfect. I rolled 7.
Yeah, so absolutely. There's basically any tool that you could want that was standard in like a household garage. So anything from like a chainsaw to screwdrivers, hammers, all wrenches, whatever, all those normal like things that you would find in a suburban person's garage. So there's not enough room here for there to be like a table saw or something like that, but the little like circular saw, handheld circular saw, chainsaw, leaf blower, all of these types of things are there.
Perfect.
Okay, so you have a trunk full of garage tools.
Just in case. I feel like if someone comes after us with a chainsaw, that looks intense.
I volunteer to be Chainsaw Man.
I found it. I'm going to like look at you, and then I'm going to look at me, and then I'm going to look at you and be like, okay.
Or at least the circular saw. I feel like I could make that intimidating.
If you are taking one of them that you're going to carry with you, apart from
we can put him in the trunk.
Apart from
fine.
The trunk, I would note it on your sheet so that you remember okay. You have it if something happens.
I'm assuming that the chainsaws are not connected. Well, why are they fully function separately?
No, they're gas powered. They're or power cell powered, so they do not have to be plugged in.
Excellent.
So should we like keep going? Should we like keep driving? How late is it?
By now it is definitely getting toward evening. The Onos is setting. Trey and Patru are in the sky. And Dovim is also there. So you've still got 3 suns. But it is toward like the end of the day or of the main like work period. So I'd put it at like 5 p.m., 6 p.m. Something around more closer to 6 since Onos is getting ready to set.
We're relatively safe here, at least safer than we would be out on the open highway in a car. So we could just post up here for the night, continue in the morning.
I mean, I think the real question is, are we going to go investigate that smoke?
Oh, yeah. probably. Let's go investigate the smoke, because I'm getting hungry. Wait, we had some food. They gave us some food.
They did.
Didn't they give us food?
You have some food, yeah.
Introduce ourselves as the new neighbors.
It's like essentially like MREs.
So nasty. Yeah, we should go get some some better food. And I have this convenient handkerchief, which could be used as fuel.
True. All right, well, let's investigate, but let's be sneaky about it.
Oh, that's not forte. Ring. I'll let one of you...
Well, then you stay here.
Okay. I mean, I'll go over there in the general direction, but probably the sneaky.
Wait, actually, what if we send you out there first?
Okay.
You can ask them questions.
Yeah. Sure, let's
and
do that.
Get some information from them.
Tell them not sending
and
cars.
We'll just be watching from afar in case anything weird happens.
That works for me.
And are you fine going by yourself, or would you like a friend?
You can go.
I can go.
Sure. Let's head on in.
All right. We'll hang back. Give us a signal if you need help.
Okay. It'll probably be screaming or the sound of a gun.
But maybe both
for me.
Is the house 2 stories by chance? If it is, I'd like to try and maybe post up in one of the top windows to see if I can watch over things.
So the house that you are currently in is about a block away from where
We can break into a different house.
We'll just break into every house along the way till we find a good spot. I guess I'll just try to follow far enough away that I won't be too obvious, but try to keep him in sight if I can.
Okay.
Same.
So you're all heading over to the house that had the smoke coming up out of it and the scent.
And we closed the garage door before we left.
Okay.
So no one can come and take the car or the or the tools.
All right. Who is doing what?
I'm going to walk up the front driveway.
I'm going to follow behind, but also kind of check in. Any people, dogs.
I'm watching from behind a bush.
It's eerily quiet in this neighborhood. There's no sound.
Hello? I'm a faculty member with Sarah's University here to do a research study. Is anybody here? I can smell your food.
Door opens and a woman in her 40s comes out.
Hi, ma'am.
And says, "University? Did you say university?"
I did.
"University?" And then you see a crowd of people kind of pushing up behind her.
Are you having a dinner party?
Oh, indeed, indeed. Come inside, university.
Ooh.
I didn't introduce myself. I'm sorry. My name's Lena, 42.
University. Yes, university.
That's not my name. That's where I work. I'd like to think I'm not defined by my work.
Come inside. We will eat. Come inside.
Eat what?
What are we having for dinner?
Eat.
Okay.
Come inside.
We will eat. I have a few questions for you first. I gotta
inside,
ask.
Inside.
First off, are
and
you
she gestures
to...
and the people behind her. She says, "University, inside." And a couple of people come out and just grab you by the hands and start dragging you towards the door.
I go, hey. You have to sign IRB first.
You can't touch just yet.
You are university. Yes, you are university. Come inside.
I'm not the university.
Ooh, I have a sense of motion as a skill. I need that of the crowd.
You can. That is a target number of 18.
Oh.
So your skill will drop that to a difficulty 5, which will be a target of 15.
Will I hit it properly?
Do you have anything else that would help you with that?
With sense of motion?
Yeah.
I have social interaction. And then I also have demeanor.
I whisper to you and I go, "Do you think they intend to eat us?" That's me helping.
No. That is the vibe I'm getting. I'm getting a very like Hannibal-esque vibe.
So you can reduce by a maximum of 2 using skills. You've definitely got 2 skills you can use. So you can reduce it down by 2 levels using skills, which would put it at a difficulty 3 and the target. Wait, sorry, difficulty. Where was I?
Boiling green. Oh no.
Sorry, difficulty 4. So the target would be 12.
Okay, so 12. I can try.
Unless. If you want to spend some effort, you can bring it down further.
Do you have any edge? Is this intellect?
This would be intellect. So you do have an edge in intellect, which would mean that you would only need to spend 2 from the pool to spend a level of effort.
Okay, I'm fine doing that.
Yeah, so go ahead and spend 2 of your intellect pool. That will bring the difficulty down to 3, which would put your target at 9.
Perfect. I feel like this is a lot to confirm that I'm about to eat. All right, let's see if these dice are... I'm not joking, exactly.
All right. Yeah, they're definitely giving off some, like, vibes. They seem like they're salivating as they're looking at Lena They're licking their lips. They're like smelling like, ooh, yes, this one will be good. They definitely are giving you those slightly not all there, interested in eating your flesh vibes.
Can I see them from where I am? Obviously not in that detail, but can I see them grabbing Lena?
You can definitely see that they've grabbed Lena's hands and are pulling her towards the toward the entrance.
I don't know if my contract is still in effect, but that's definitely not allowed as per the bodyguard contract. So, not excited about shooting them yet, so let's fire another warning shot with the rifle. Maybe, in, I don't know, I must fire into a house until I know what's going on, but into the yard, let's say.
Yeah, I'm not going to make you roll this time because the warning shot, they take notice. They don't immediately run away.
Oh dear.
They, in response, the woman who was the first to poke her head out the door says, "University! They're doing a magic on us! Kill them!" And they're attacking.
No!
Oops. Can I use the demeanor of...
You can try. Yeah.
Oh, no. Whatever. You can try. That's not good.
Now that I've enraged them, sorry.
I look over and I'm just like...
I look over at you and I'm like, magic. What sort of nonsense is this?
Counting the woman, there are a total of 5 people that you have seen.
Oh.
So you want to, what do you want to do that you're going to command?
I would like to command them that we are not tasty morsels to eat. And rather there are more tastiest morsels at the university itself.
Okay. Oh. Kind of dark, but okay. let me look at this.
Basically kind of going with what they already want to do, which is eating, but like that.
So again, this is going to be an intellect roll. Mm-hmm. And that is going to be what exactly do you say to them?
I let them know now is not the time for dinner. You have to go first seek out the prime rib option at a further location tomorrow, and we will give you the instructions on how to get it.
If you say that, I would probably go, you know, my colleagues were quite soft and stuffy. They spent all their time in there. None of them really got out much, so I'd say you're probably right.
Develop the flavor.
The dean level will be much better.
So, what you said and what you followed up with, the starting difficulty on this is going to be 7, which is a target number of 21 on a d20. You are helping. Possibly.
I don't think I'm consciously helping. I think she just said something, and I was like, yeah, that makes perfect sense. I agree. It's a chance to badmouth my colleagues.
So that will... I will count that as an asset, which will drop your difficulty to 6, so the target would be 18. You have demeanor of command, which would be a skill, and are you trained or specialized in that?
I believe it's just, it said specialized when I did it, but I think we decided that was training.
It's an ability.
Yeah.
What does demeanor to do?
It, 1 hour projection of confidence, knowledge, and charisma. And I also gain a level of effort that can be applied to 1 persuasion task.
Yeah, so that will count as a level of effort. So that would drop you down to a difficulty 5. And yeah, if you wanted to spend effort, you could go further, but otherwise your target is 15.
I think I'll spend a little bit.
All right, and you have edge and intellect, right?
I do.
So you can spend one level of effort, and instead of costing 3 points from your pool, it will cost 2 points from your pool because of your edge.
Okay.
So that would put your target at 12.
Okay. I'm nervous about using this d20. I kind of almost want to switch. We'll see. Oh, it's 15. It's fine.
Surprisingly,
it escapes dice jail.
Surprisingly, you stare them down and command them to stop and tell them that you know where they can get much better food. And you manage to get them to pause. The woman is looking at you curiously and just waiting to see what you're gonna do next. So they've paused. What were you going to say, Shireen?
I was gonna whisper from my bush kind of loudly, run! And just book it back.
I am going to do a GM intrusion on that. Shireen, you are welcome to refuse it. If you do, you have to spend an experience point. Otherwise, you will get some experience points. And for the viewers, experience points in this game allow you to do a number of things. One of those is you can spend an experience point to reroll a roll. So earning them in this way can be useful for that. But yeah, so tell me whether you will accept the intrusion or not.
Okay, I'll accept the intrusion.
All right, so go ahead and mark down an additional XP on your sheet, and you have one XP to give to one of the other players, and just tell me who and why you're giving it to them.
Oh, okay. I'm gonna give the additional XP to, oh gosh, I don't, hold on.
It can be for anything. If you liked the approach that Malaka just took, you could give it to Malaka and just say that you liked what she just did, you know, any reason, honestly, just pick somebody.
Well,
and
I feel like I'm going to give the XP to Jonathan because I made Lena go to these crazy people.
I mean, I appreciate that.
You almost got eaten. Here's some experience.
would have done that anyways, but yeah. Excuse me, I need you to put out that fire.
No, and that is great. So Jonathan, go ahead and mark down an additional XP on your sheet. Yeah, so the intrusion is you shouting run breaks the spell. And they're attacking again.
Sorry.
So kind of a meta question then. I know, how can I step in and try to attack again at any time? How does that work?
Well, we are now in initiative, so you all are going to need to roll a speed roll to determine your initiative.
How do you roll a speed roll?
Yeah. So basically what it means, you're going to roll a d20, and if you roll above the highest level of your opponents, you will go before the opponents. If you roll below the highest level of the opponents, you'll go after the opponents. Otherwise, if you want to spend effort on the roll, you can do that as well. You would spend from your speed pool.
I rolled a 7.
I'm going to use effort on mine.
Do you have edge?
I don't.
Okay, so it would but be three points from your speed pool to okay, spend so a level of effort on this.
Down to 10. And I rolled a 6.
I rolled a 15.
I rolled a 1.
No!
All right, 1 second.
I was doing so well when we get out my other dice.
All right. I guess I could spend that 1 XP to re-roll my roll.
Indeed you could, if you so wish.
I will.
The target of this roll to go before them is 12.
I rolled an 8. So 7, then 8.
Yeah.
I just keep rolling, and it just go up on each turn.
I mean, if you want to try again, re-rolling a second time would be 2 XP.
Okay. I'm good.
So, who rolled above a 12?
I did. I rolled a 15. All right,
so, Shireen, you will go first, then the baddies will go next, and then Lena, Elsid, and Nim, the order that the three of you go in doesn't matter. You'll just go after the bad guys. That's how initiative works. So when it comes to your turn, you can discuss amongst yourselves who wants to go first, etc. So we'll start with Shireen.
All right. I'm going for a headshot on the main baddie who's grabbing Lena.
All right. So there is, there are a total of 4 out front who have come out and are kind of surrounding Lena, grabbing, and then there's the woman who's still sort of back near the door. One of those 4 has a tight grip on Lena's arm and is a little beefier than the others. Seems like maybe they were a construction worker. They seem stronger. Better.
Is it Charlie?
Maybe they were longshoremen. They were a laborer of some type, or possibly just worked out a lot. But they're definitely bulkier. so we'll say that you're going for that one, and you are trying to do a headshot. You said.
Yes.
Okay. The difficulty of doing a headshot on one person in a group of 5, I'm going to say it's going to be an 8, a difficulty 8. So that is a 24 target.
All right.
So you're going to have to do something to bring that down, or it will just fail.
Okay, so I'm practiced with a medium or light weapon, and I'm using a light handgun, and that's a specialty.
Okay, and light guns are also eased.
Okay.
So it'll be a speed roll.
Okay.
Let me look here. I'm trying to pull up your sheet. Light is eased. It is a speed roll, so light will drop it down to a 7 difficulty, and then you said you're trained?
I'm specialized.
Specialized. Okay.
Right, because it's, is that right?
Where did the specialization come from?
Probably from one of the special abilities. There's one. I know there was one that was all special.
That's weapons. So yeah. Practiced with medium or light weapon.
Yeah, okay. That's the one. I have it in my.
That's
skills,
fine. I'm not gonna dwell on it too much. So specialized will that will count and drop it down by another 2. So we started at 8. You've dropped it by 3, putting it at 5, which would be a 15. Anything else that you can think of that would lower it further?
I think I'll spend some of my pool for to use effort.
Okay. So that'd be 3, it'd be 3 right? points from your speed pool. Which will drop it down to a difficulty 4, and that'll put your target number at 12.
All right, I'm gonna try to roll for this now.
You got this.
The 12?
12, yeah.
So, does that work?
You rolled a 12?
Yeah, I rolled a 12.
Yeah. So, yeah, you managed to, you just...
By the skin of my teeth.
You... Take a moment and your mind just focuses and you become really calm. Got this gun in your hand and you're very familiar with how it works. Take aim and just squeeze that trigger ever so gently. And the shot goes exactly where you want it. It hits this guy in the head. It kind of glances off. Like, it doesn't, like, go straight into his skull. So it hits the head and ricochets to the side off of his skull. So he does take damage, but he's not incapacitated by a single shot. He definitely looks like you rung his bell.
Oh my god.
So I will say...
Who are these people?
Cannibals.
Like, you managed to... You must have just hit it at an angle that just... He's definitely going to be impaired. But he's not down. You don't drop him immediately.
Dang. Okay. Is that all I can do? Like, as my first move... As my move...
Yeah, if you wanted to move or something, you could do that as well. But that your main action was shooting.
I guess I'll just move closer to, like, the group, like,
Okay.
Not the bad guys, us good
guys.
Yeah,
so I would say you were probably within like, long distance, so if you want to move into short distance.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Then it will be their turn. And, so they are currently surrounding Lena. Mm-hmm. You just got the attention of the big brutish one, though, Shireen. And he is a little distracted by being shot in the head. He drops Lena's arm and turns and charges at Rude. You.
Rude, sir.
He's trying to tackle you. So you're going to need to make a speed defense roll. To see if you can dodge out of the way. This is gonna be... I'll put the difficulty at a 3. So a target of 9 to dodge out of the way of this guy who is just charging at you, trying to knock you down.
Okay. Does my jumping skill help at all?
I would say yes. Jumping would help, so that would drop it down to a difficulty 3 with a target of 9.
Okay. All right. I'm going. 13!
Yeah, so you manage, you see him, he telegraphs his movements, you see him turn around, and that palm that came over you when you shot him is... Some of it's still there, and you see, like, it's in slow motion. He turns and starts charging towards you, and you manage to just jump out of the way, and he barrels on past. running into the bush that you had been hiding in before.
Nice.
I go, everyone make note of any erratic behavior so I can write it down later.
So the other three, though, are all going to try and... they're not attacking per se. They are trying to drag Lena inside. The three of them working together are trying to drag you inside, Lena. It's going to be really difficult to resist that on your own. So I'm putting the difficulty at 8.
That's cool.
So you need to roll a 24 to resist being pulled inside the house.
I mean, do I actually need to roll, or do I just fail?
Well, is there anything that you can do to bring that down and make it something you could roll?
I mean, I can jump. I mean, I can run away. Like, I have multiple things for running, like fleet of foot, which allows, but it seems like that's triggered on my turn. More so than on their turn. So that was sort of my thought was,
so those,
I don't know if there's anything I can do now.
Those abilities can be used if you have a way that you think they can be justified in this situation. So if you think that skill in running could help you to resist being pulled into the house, then yeah, it could be used as an asset or as a skill to reduce this.
I mean, my plan is just to shoot one and then run.
That is potentially an option, but it's not your turn. So yeah, right
that's
now
what
you're...
I, so that's what I was like. I guess I'm just going to let him pull me in there. I do have specifically a sawed-off shotgun, so I'm just going to hold it up to someone's chest and pull the trigger.
I mean, you do have an edge in speed. You could spend 2 points of effort to reduce it by one. Which would still technically be impossible. We can count the running skill, which would reduce it by one more.
I mean, are they just trying to pull me inside?
Which would put you to a 6, and you would have to roll above an 18.
I mean, I think I would just go with it and shoot, and on my turn, because the fleet of foot lets me attack and then run.
Okay.
In addition, and I also have a bunch of skills for running.
Yeah, then they are going to successfully pull you inside the house.
What's it like in here?
On their turn. And Raimali, who is the woman in her 40s. Sorry, you never asked her name, so I never said what it was. Mm-hmm. But her name is Raimali, because that's what I have written here. She closes the door. She goes back inside and closes the door. So they have captured Lena and brought you inside.
What does it look like in here? Honestly, I think she'd be like, I kind of want to see what they're doing in there.
There are additional people inside. Ooh, they are like in various states of dishevelment. Some of them are wearing shirts but no pants. They're unwashed. There's definitely a smell. Of the place, there's puddles of liquid on the floor. There's a couple of butchered somethings in a corner. Definitely bones. You're uncertain whether they're animal or human. There are a couple of kids wandering around, also not well clothed and not clean. They basically just look like people who have been existing mostly as animals and are just holed up in this house. The house itself seems to be perfectly structurally sound. It doesn't seem like it was ever burned. It's a lovely house with what used to be very expensive looking furniture, quite well designed. But yeah, it's got
gross. It's gross is what you're saying.
It's got bodily fluids and other excrement smeared across various parts of it, and the furniture is like torn up so that like the stuffing has been pulled out to make little nests. It's not a pleasant sight.
Yeah.
Now in initiative, it is Lena, Elsid, and Nim. It's all of your turn, and you can go in whatever order you want.
I'll let y'all go first, so that I can react based on what y'all do.
That worked.
Well, my original plan went out the window when he went in the window.
You could go in the window.
Well, I'm a bodyguard, not really the smartest person in the world, but I do have some MacGyver-esque tendencies, and we have a lot of liquor, and I have duct tape. So...
Okay. You want to make a Molotov?
I do.
All right.
And then... Do I need to roll for that? I have the Tinker ability.
Remind me what that does.
Just kind of helps you make things do other things. I think MacGyver is actually mentioned in the description.
I believe I have had this ability before as a player.
It's hard to pass up.
I'm just looking it up. It's on 192.
Especially in the setting.
That would be your action. You wouldn't be able to actually use it this turn, but you can craft one. And potentially somebody else could take it from you and use it. But you would only be able to craft it this turn. It would the ability costs one intellect point to use. And then you can make a device do something different from its original purpose. So bottles of alcohol become bombs.
I'm guessing I can't see anybody inside the house from a distance, right?
No. The exterior, once they're all inside, it's eerily quiet here, and the windows are darkened. It's like sundown, so like Onos down. The light is getting dimmer. You can't really see inside very well.
Okay, I'm gonna make it, spend the intellect point, and yell, gonna burn them out to the rest of people so they know what I'm doing.
Alright. So you managed to craft a bomb. Molotov cocktail.
I love that we have... the NCSU Libraries has joined your stream. We have ridden a bulldozer while intoxicated, built a bomb, and broke into something. We're doing good.
Yeah. All right. Who's next?
Yeah, I guess it would be... And then... I forgot how to pronounce it, but did she close the door?
Ramali did. She went inside and closed the door.
Is it locked, though?
You would have to try it to find out.
I'm going to try. I'm going to draw out my small pistol because I don't really have... I left the chainsaw. This was the moment. How would I have known? Anyway, so I'm going to take out my small little pistol and I'm going to get ready to open up the door and shoot whoever I can see.
Okay. Yeah, you open the door and... that is going to be a speed roll to shoot. honestly, not going to be too difficult to hit somebody. I'm going to, though, set the difficulty at 5 to see if you avoid hitting Lena. So that is a target of 15. Since you're just opening the door and shooting blindly, it is a target of 15 to shoot without hitting Lena.
And this doesn't, because I have practice with light weapons, that does nothing.
So that would drop it down by 1 to a 4, which would be a 12. Do you have anything else?
I don't know how, wait, you hear this, because I feel like this is a stretch if I argue this, is I have hacked the impossible.
What is the description of that one?
It can persuade robots, machines, and computers to curious if they're a pistol machine.
Not in that sense.
Okay. No. I was just curious. I was like, I might as
well
ask.
That was a darn That's a darn good try, though.
I know. I was like,
most of role playing games are like an exercise in rhetoric.
Yeah. So
true.
Yeah, not in that way.
Yeah. The...
You can spend effort if you want. It'd be 3 points from your speed pool to do that, though.
It'd be. Well, and right now you said it's out of 12.
Current target is 12.
I'm going to try to beat a 12.
All right. You have experience points to reroll if you have to.
Perfect, perfect. Yeah. I also switched money on this. Good, because it was a 15.
Nice.
All right. So, yeah, you manage to shoot in there, and you avoid hitting Lena, and you manage to hit one of the others. I'm going to go ahead and say that you hit... they all have names. Well, the main ones that were dragging Lena in have names. So I'm going to say that you hit Pelton. It's just a light pistol?
It's just a light pistol. I believe it's 2 points damage?
2 points of damage, yep. All right. So then it'll be Lena's turn.
I'm going to pull out my sawed-off shotgun and just fire at anyone who is still close slash grabbing at me and go, "Sirs and madams, I'm afraid I cannot be here any longer. If you are not going to sign the IRB, it would be a... you're questioning all of my research. I'm going to shoot, and then I'm going to run out the open door."
Okay. Yeah, so shooting a gun is a speed roll.
Okay.
You've got a sawed-off shotgun, you're in a room full of people, you're gonna hit. So I'm not even gonna make you roll, because you're not trying to avoid hitting anybody, and yeah. You're surrounded by people, so you definitely
hit
somebody.
Everybody.
It's a magic shot, hits everybody in the room.
And yeah, we'll say that you hit a couple of them. And then you turn to run. Mm-hmm. I do need, I'm going to make you do a speed roll to see if you can get out the door without being grabbed.
Got it.
We'll set this as, we'll say it's difficult. So that's difficulty 4 with a target of 12.
Okay. So I have endurance, fleet of foot, and the running skills.
All right. So you can lower by 2 using skills. So that would drop it to, since you've got 3 skills, you more than hit that. Drops it to difficulty 2 with a target of 6. Anything else?
I could spend effort. I might go ahead and do that. I have edge.
Okay, so it'd be 2 points to spend effort, and that would drop it to a difficulty of 2, and your target is 6.
Or does that drop it to 1 and target of 3?
Wait, I started at difficult and then dropped it 4. So yeah, it's a target of 3. You're right.
I rolled a 4. I'm glad I did that.
Yeah. So you managed to... managed to get your shotgun in your hand, pull the trigger, you manage to hurt 2 or 3 of them, you're not sure. They let go of you. You turn and start running out the door, and you manage to just push Nim out of the way as you go through the door back out into the dusk.
Okay, the integrity of research is important.
So, they are all turning toward you. The 4 of you have definitely caught the attention of the entire household. It is Shireen's turn again.
Okay. Can I take the Molotov cocktail and throw it into the house?
Yeah, you can certainly do that.
Okay. I'm gonna do that.
Burn those children.
Yeah, so you're all in close proximity to the door. It's not really going to be much of an issue for you to get it through the door. So it's lit. It's a bottle of alcohol. How much have you been drinking? You were able to operate heavy machinery without destroying too much more of the city. So we'll say that you're not intoxicated to the point where you would miss an entire open door with a bottle. And yeah, we'll just, you toss it in and it lights up. And you discover that the pools of liquid that were on the floor were wine. And so they're lighting up as well. The entire interior of this house just starts to blaze. You start to hear screeches and screams from the people inside. I'm going to say we're out of initiative at this point. They are coming towards the door, but it's a simple step for Nim to just close the door before they get to it. And they're on fire and weren't very stable mentally to begin with. So you have time to retreat from the situation if you wish to do so before they manage to get out the door.
Yeah, I'm going to start retreating back to that professor's house we were at.
I do feel like we betrayed our fire patrol oath, but
we're allowed to start fires. They said if we wear the handkerchief, we're allowed to.
You're right, Professor. You're right. I'm sorry. We should still retreat.
All
right.
So you all retreat back to Zithu's 106's house, and you have a moment to collect yourselves. And while you're doing that, we will take our break.
Okay.
Hello. Welcome back to our show, The Role of Play. We're going to pick up with our characters who have just fought a group of cannibals in a roughly suburban upper-class neighborhood on the edge of downtown, so not really suburban, but whatever. In this ruined in the ruined city of Sarrow City on Calgash, following in the aftermath of Nightfall on a planet with six suns where it is never night. So you've all retreated to the home of Zithuz 106, who was a friend of Lena, who had a house in this neighborhood, and you managed to find a car that is operational in his garage, as well as a number of tools that you've loaded into the trunk. You probably don't need to worry too much about the cannibals that are about a block over, since you lit their house on fire with a Molotov cocktail to escape them. So you could wait until Onos Rise tomorrow in this house if you want before continuing on, or you could move on out tonight and try and make some distance. You have 300 or 400 miles to go to get to Amgondo National Park, if that is indeed still your destination. And like I said, you have a car or a bulldozer that you can use to move in that direction.
I feel like I'm feeling a little sketched out after our encounter. I'm also a little nervous that the fire brigade is going to come after us, because now there's a house on fire that essentially we set on fire.
We're the fire
brigade. I feel like...
Yeah, yes. But there's no way.
Yes. That's true.
This is a fire.
I feel like we should drive.
I'm good with driving. I've already left a bad review on Nextdoor for this neighborhood, so I'm done.
I mean, like, we could go in shifts if folks want to sleep while we're, you know, while one person drives, if we all know how to drive.
I will need time to take down notes. I got a lot of questions for y'all about what we just experienced. Anything? I need your mind sharp. Need your
show me the IRB consent form first. Show me that IRB consent form first.
Okay. Pulls out IRB consent form.
I'm gonna start reviewing it.
Excellent. I appreciate your dedication.
Shireen,
understand
liquor.
Listen, I've seen enough students
liquor.
Try to get me to sign off on stuff. I need to make sure.
Right, yeah. That's fair. I appreciate your dedication to the research process and making sure that you fully comprehend what you're
students have told me about you, so I know I have an idea of what I'm getting into.
Just don't
all
pay
right,
attention
you
to
two
page
converse,
six.
Converse in the back seat, and we'll drive.
Hey, you drive. I'll nap, and then we'll take a shift. I don't trust them to drive just right now.
Hey.
Yeah, sounds good.
So you're all traveling in the car and leaving the bulldozer behind.
Alas, poor bulldozer. But yes.
Goodbye.
Yeah.
Set it on fire before.
Do you want do you want to just like bring it to the burning house, put it there, and just like
just drive over the house?
Yeah, like set it off and like gently
or put a brick on the pedal and just kind of put it.
Yeah. Do we want to do that? Like bulldoze the house?
No evidence.
We have definitely left morally gray in the dust.
Were we ever?
I go. Y'all didn't see
we
inside
could...
that house.
So you pilot.
I think we're in the right.
You pilot the bulldozer over to the burning cannibal house, and set a stone on the accelerator of the bulldozer, and aim it to the house, and it slowly pushes into the house, knocking it down, and itself becoming engulfed in the flames.
Go.
Yay!
Had bad bikes. I play them.
and then we drive off.
The fire brigade right. would be proud.
I feel like they would have.
We did try to put the fire out at least.
I mean when the bulldozer makes it out the other side of the house and starts setting the whole neighborhood on fire, they might not approve. But you know, you're beyond
it's
that.
Okay, we're
that
was
we can
fine.
Just blame the cannibals.
Yeah, that was the work.
They should have stopped it.
They were fine young cannibals. All right. So you progress.
I go, I don't know about y'all, but from my first impressions of the Fire Brigade, they're all about going above and beyond when it comes to use of force. So I feel like we did exactly what they would have
done. I mean, how else were they cooking the
They
the
had a fire.
Meat?
I mean,
exactly.
They did have a fire.
We're just trying
they
to
broke
put
the
out.
Law.
Out
and
the
we
fire.
Just took the fight fire with fire euphemism terribly literally.
I mean, we just threw some alcohol in there. It was probably their fire that started.
We were just told to stop
people from starting fire. They won't start fire.
Yeah.
All
right. So you drive on through this district of nice homes that is strangely untouched compared to the rest of the city, but hides dangers behind the doors, apparently. And as you reach the edge of this neighborhood, there is an on-ramp to the Great Southern Highway. You drive up that on-ramp, and who is driving?
I am.
I need you to make a speed defense roll. And this is just going to be a difficulty 3 with a target of 9.
Okay. I'm just going to roll.
Okay. If you've got, if you have any sort of perception skills, I would say that those could count towards this roll.
Does danger sense count? Or I think that's only for initiative.
Let me see what that does.
I think it's only initiative. It says your initiative task is eased. You pay the cost each time the ability is used. One speed point.
Yeah, no, this isn't an initiative roll, so...
All right, so I don't think I have any perception.
If I can help, I have listening.
It would not, that listening would not help.
All right, I'm going for it.
So it would be visual perception or...
I have searching?
I've got IDing or assessing danger.
I would say assessing danger, you could use that as a help. Okay. And that could drop it down... from demanding to standard, so your target would be 6.
I rolled a 4.
Okay. So if you want to spend 1 XP, you could re-roll that. Otherwise, we'll go with that result.
Oh, yes, I want to do that. Nope, I'm going to spend 1 XP. Okay.
Oh, no.
Fail.
A 5.
Okay. So, you, I will say, the rules that we set for the XP, if you have 2 more XP, you could reroll it again, otherwise,
All right. I do have 2 more XP. But now I will have 0 XP, so I'm gonna just do it. I'm gonna do it. I'm rerolling. Wait, I'm gonna switch my dice.
That one goes to dice jail.
Yeah. An 8.
8?
Was that
yes. 8. 8 gets okay. it. So I will just mention for anybody watching, the standard cipher rules let you spend 1 XP to reroll, and basically you can do that as many times as you want. I modified that slightly so that it's exponential, so the first reroll is 1, the second reroll is 2, the third is 4, the... fourth is 8, and so on. so, yes, you manage to see, as you're coming up that on-ramp, the Great Southern Highway is completely littered with crashed cars, bodies. It has not been cleared. People were clearly in their cars and driving when Nightfall happened, and you managed to stop the car before becoming another crashed car in this mix.
We should have kept the bulldozer.
The, The bulldozer went to Valhalla. It cannot be mourned now.
So you have a fully functional, undamaged car, and there is a highway that is basically blocked with wreck after wreck after wreck. It was a busy highway when Nightfall happened.
Are there other roads?
It's possible that you could progress on surface streets. Your time to reach Amgondo would be significantly greater. There is no direct path. The Great Southern Highway is a raised highway that crosses and passes over cities, over lakes and rivers, over preserved forest land that doesn't really have roads through it, etc. It is the most direct path, but you could try to go overland using surface streets. That might require getting a map, and would probably take you significantly out of your way on your way there.
Are there any large, like, long-haul trucks around that don't look completely destroyed?
There are trucks. Whether they're completely destroyed or not, you would have to get closer and investigate.
Are there, like, motorcycles?
There probably are some single-person narrow vehicles. I would say they're not exactly like the motorcycles that we have here. They have, like, little closed cabins, but they seat one.
They have, like, little side buggy. I'm thinking of the alcohol.
It's very important.
Or are there four of them?
Basically, they would be the equivalent of, like, a single-person car. So if you took the concept of a car and shrunk it down so that there was just a single seat.
Like a Fiat.
So they have like a trunk in the back. It's not as big as the trunk that you would get on like the four or five seater that you're currently in.
Storage capability if possible.
But there is storage capability. You would have to search for a little bit, but you can probably find four functional single-seat cars.
So, I do have another plan, y'all, we might consider. Mm-hmm. What if we found a really big, mean truck? One that hopefully was still operating. And then we duct-taped a whole bunch of car hoods to the front of it in sort of a triangle shape. Yeah, I've got a lot of duct tape.
Mad Max vibe.
Yes. Yeah, I've probably got some spiky bits. We could put duct tape on there as well, just for funsies.
We could also attach one of the bus to the front.
I love this. See, we should have worked more at the university together. We just sort of click.
I was in the office. No one. You don't talk to me unless you're in trouble.
That sounds like a great plan. I'll wait here and take my notes while y'all chain together chainsaws and spikes and whatever.
I also have a duct tape roll as well to help with that.
See? Double.
Yeah, I have duct tape too.
Oh, triple.
And I got a padlock with keys.
Okay, so we can do some witness me moments later if necessary.
So first, you're going to have to find an appropriate vehicle amidst all of this mess that is operational.
Okay.
Finding a big, mean truck that you could affix car doors to make a plow to push other cars out of the way. This is going to be pretty hard to do, to find one that is still operational amidst all of this mess. I'm going to set the difficulty at 7.
What kind of roll is it?
That's a 21.
Might, speed, or intellect.
It's intellect, because this is like an investigation, searching type roll.
I have searching.
I have I have assessing quality, importance, function, power. I'm guessing that's more for, like, small objects. Probably not for searching.
Yeah, so. That's not really for searching. That's for figuring out whether something is functional. So that could go into it, potentially.
I've got the intellect booster thing, but I think it's probably better for somebody else to take point on the searching side.
I mean, I'll search for a bit. Consider that my contribution to this.
So who's leading it? Is it Lena or Elsid?
Okay.
So Lena's going to lead. We're starting at difficulty 7. Elsid, you said you have that assessing thing that could help with this task because you're trying to find an operational track. So I will say that can help, which would be an asset. Searching, are you trained or specialized in searching?
Trained.
All right, so the searching skill plus help from Elsid will drop it to a 5. Anything else in skills or assets? So if you want to put some effort into that, that'll drop it to a difficulty 4, so you need to roll better than a 12.
I'm gonna sing some I think they're all broken.
Yeah. So you don't manage. You do manage to find a big truck, but it is when you actually get in and assess the quality of the engine and whether it's functional and operational. The engine itself seems okay. The axle of the truck is actually cracked in half. So the there's no way that you can drive it without finding a similar truck, changing out the entire axle, or swapping engines. It just doesn't seem like it's going to work out.
Now, let's see, I got MacGyver ability. I have a stick. I can fix that, right?
No.
We could attach some spikes to the cars if you want.
It's just not the same.
I mean, someone could put the chainsaw on the front of theirs.
Okay, that makes me feel a little better about it.
So, I guess we have to walk?
But, no, I said you should be able to find 4 operational motorcycle cars.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. All right. Let's get our motorcycle cars.
There are a lot of those around, and yeah, finding some that are not damaged enough to cause them to be inoperable shouldn't be too hard. You managed to find 4 of them.
Okay. Load all my stuff and start driving.
I'm actually going to put on goggles at this point. I don't know if necessarily that's going to help me. But it feels like it could.
Well, so essentially, in this world, what I would say is they allow you to see as though Onos is still in the sky.
Okay.
So Onos being the brightest star, it's a sol type star, so like a bright yellow star. It is the main sun for the planet, and so when it's not in the sky, things are dimmer. So what these goggles would let you do is see as though Onos was in the sky. So any tasks requiring vision, I would say, are E by 1 with those. Yeah, so basically you all need to just drive down this highway, avoiding the wreckage. So That's easy to do if you want to move slowly. If you want to try and make any sort of speed, then that's going to be a speed run.
I think I'm good with being slow and careful on this one, if you all are.
I'm good with being slow. And just to verify, no one put the chainsaw on theirs, right?
I did not, so it is all you, Nim. Okay. Please, please live at least some small part of my dream.
Do you want me to? Because would you consider this, if I could do this?
If you want to mount the chainsaw on it, you know, between you and Elsid's tinker ability, yeah, you can absolutely
just
do
to
it.
Get through, like, if there's, like, a really, like, big pile left. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I'm sort of picturing one of those, like a Vespa with a bubble on it with a giant chainsaw on the front. That makes me very happy.
I mean, this is a standard household chainsaw. Not like a
lumberjack chainsaw.
As I'm watching y'all do this, I go, I think you may need to be...
I'm fine with that, because I got the vision, I got the chainsaw. Good.
Yeah. We do seem determined to let everybody know that we're coming. I'm kind of okay with it.
I mean, we're the law, I think, what I heard.
Does our authority still stand outside of the city, on
all matters of fire? Our law is absolute.
You don't know how far the fire patrol's authority extends.
Okay. Let's be honest. Do we really think they had any authority?
True.
I mean, they didn't show me a badge. They showed me a script. I have some of those at home in my. Could have come out and been like, "I'm part of the gun brigade. We're in charge of this now." Like that doesn't, you're not like sanctioned.
This seems like more bureaucratic red tape to me.
Yeah. I've been reading too much ACRL. My first thought was authority is contextual. All right.
Oh, and on that note, you proceed down the highway for a good part of the night. It's approaching Onos Rise when you come upon a pileup that is just massive. It's like two like 18 wheelers like head on into each other, and they're across all of the traffic lanes, and cars then ran into them and piled up. So it's like 8 feet tall, 9 feet tall of cars piled onto these trucks, and it's all burnt out, and there's jagged points like sticking everywhere and shattered glass all over. Your little motorcycle cars are not gonna find a way through this.
Well, one might.
Chainsaw!
Well, do we want to check if like the trucks are functional in any way, and do we want to take one of them, or is it like really bad?
They are like shredded. They're not going to be operational.
Two things. One, this seems like a trap. Two, I think this could be a fire hazard that we might want to.
Oh gosh.
We do have more liquor bottles, though. I think I'm going to need more.
That was part of. I think they said we were supposed to burn things.
I think you were less coherent than Altenol thought you were.
How much alcohol have you been drinking?
I don't want to waste any more booze if we don't have to.
Find a different way to set these fires.
Okay. Okay, I'm good with that.
I've got a flashlight. I can probably jury-rig it into a lighter.
Batteries? Can't you use batteries?
Unless they took that. They might have taken that.
If you had a flashlight that was battery operated, yeah, they kept that.
Okay.
Because that would have been seen as a fire starter.
Oh.
Curse you, fire brigade.
Does that mean that my flashlight was taken too? Son of a bitch.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh. All right.
Anybody
Let's
got
see.
Explosives?
Let's see.
Go ahead.
Would my intelligent enhancement cipher be helpful here? At all to figure out, like, how do we get through this?
I would say yeah. If you want to make an intelligence roll or an intellect roll to see how to get through this, and you want to activate that cipher to help with that, then yeah.
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay. we will set the difficulty to start at 6. What does your cipher do?
It's all of the user's tasks involving intelligent deduction are eased by 2 steps for 1 hour, and then in the subsequent hour, the strain hinders the same tasks by 2 steps.
Okay. So that cipher will immediately drop it down to a difficulty 4. What else you got?
Well, I don't have a lot of smarts, so... Let's see. I guess I could just spend one of my, or some of my pool.
I would say, your training in climbing and your training in escaping could both be used here.
Can I help? I also have fits of insight.
Sure. If you want to help, that I would say would count. So that all of those combined drops you to a difficulty 1 with a target of 3, and if you wanted to get it to a difficulty 0, you could spend effort to do that, but
no, I think I'll just roll.
You got this.
Oh dear. What did you do?
You don't got this?
I rolled a 1.
Oh no. Dice jail. Forever.
You can 3D.
And I don't have any more XP.
Want me to 3D print you a dice jail?
Yeah, if you want to donate XP,
I will give you my
you
1 XP.
That.
As a return on the XP that you gave me earlier.
And you were helping on this roll anyway.
Yeah,
so.
That's true, I was.
Okay, I am busting out the other set of dice. Both those are in dice jail. Okay, let's try this again. Oh god, I'm scared.
It's a 3.
Okay. 11.
Alright. So with you take a few minutes, you get out of your little single person car, walk over to this barrier of just massive barrier of mangled metal, and Lena steps out and kind of walks over there with you, and while you're kind of poking about looking for any way through, and Lena's kind of like chattering in the background about tenure and academia, and it helps to keep your mind just unfocused enough on the task at hand that you manage to see a path. You won't be able to bring the cars, but you could climb through this and get out the other side safely, and yeah, you found a path through, but it will require you to leave the cars.
All right. I'm going to relay this information to the rest of my group.
I grab the liquor.
I grab the chainsaw.
Good.
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 I grab my notes.
Good. We have what, 7 bottles of liquor left? I think
Shireen
and I drained 2, and then we committed totally justified homicide with the other one.
Yeah.
I don't remember how many I started you with, so that's fine. Okay. All right. So this path.
So you.
Will require a little bit of climbing to get through. I'm gonna say this is a might roll for you all to navigate through this without hurting yourselves. And it is a demanding ask in order to get through there without cutting yourself on one of the jagged pieces of metal or on some broken piece of glass. So that is gonna be a difficulty 3 with a target of 9, and you each will need to make this roll to successfully get through without hurting yourself.
Okay. I have
so,
climbing.
I have climbing
yep,
too.
So that would that ability in climbing, this skill in climbing would drop you down. If you're trained, it would drop you down by 1 to a difficulty 2. If you're specialized, it would drop you down to a difficulty 1. It would drop you down two steps to a difficulty one.
Would endurance help? Is the climb, like, arduous?
Yeah, sure. Endurance would be fine.
Would escaping help?
I would say escaping would count. That's why I let you use it for your investigation on this. So yeah, it would also help you get through to the other side.
Womp womp. I rolled a one. I got it down to three and then rolled a one.
Okay.
I can give you an XP if you like.
Sure. If this goes any better. It did. 15. Oh. Much better.
Okay.
Okay.
I rolled a 13.
Okay. So the two of you managed to get through without hurting yourselves. Nim or Elsid, do you have anything that will help you drop it from difficulty 3?
Go ahead, Nim.
I do not. I didn't take anything that would help me this night.
Okay. So your target number would be 9.
11.
Yep, you managed to get through just fine. Elsid?
I'm trained in balancing, so that would bring it down by 1.
Yeah, sure, that'll drop it to a difficulty 2 with a target of 6.
And then I've got 1 edge in might, so I could just spend 2 points,
if
is that correct?
If you spend 2 points, that would drop your difficulty to 1 with a target of 3.
Let's do that, because I've been rolling poorly tonight. 7.
Alright, so you will successfully get through. I am going to do a GM intrusion on you, Elsid. You can either spend an XP to refuse it or accept it, and you will earn some XP.
I will accept it.
All right, so go ahead, and you have 1 additional XP, and then you have 1 XP to give to one of the other players. Just let me know who and why.
I'm going to give it to Nim, because she mounted the chainsaw on the car, and that makes me happy.
Okay. Chainsaw makes everybody happy. Thank you.
As you're getting to the far side, you're managing to just get out one of the, like, car doors shifts and falls on your ankle, and you are pinned by that door. It doesn't seem to have hurt you, but you can't fully get out of this wreckage at the moment. And so you all, your attention is drawn back to Elsid because you hear this crash, and then Elsid seems to be stuck.
You okay?
In this rubble.
Sort of okay, need help.
Use your muscles.
What happened?
I tried that.
Can we not see them at all?
Elsid is right at the edge, so was basically out, and then just as you were pulling your leg out of the last bit, you got pinned at the ankle.
I'm going to go up to you.
Climb up there and help.
I mean,
I've got a crowbar in my backpack.
Ooh.
A crowbar would help.
So I will hand that over if I can.
And so this is just going to be a difficulty 2 task to be able to kind of shift that door enough to free Elsid.
You want to do it, Nim?
I can do it. Although, I'm assuming this is going to be a might?
It is might, okay. Yes. It's starting at difficulty 2. The crowbar would make it difficulty 1.
Oh.
And if somebody wants to help you, that would put it at difficulty 0.
That would be great.
So difficulty 0, you technically do not have to roll. If you want to roll, you are welcome to do so, as you could get some sort of minor or major effect, but you also run the risk of rolling a 1, in which case I get a free GM intrusion.
I would like to roll for flavor.
Okay. Go for it.
I'm scared.
It is a 16.
Okay. Yeah. So 16, you just succeed. It doesn't get any of the effects.
These are my good dice.
Yay.
They haven't failed me.
Yeah, so you managed to free Elsid from this rogue door that had pinned him. And as you all turn around from this barrier that you managed to pass through, you can see approaching, so there is another barrier in front of you, a few hundred feet in front of you. This one is clearly constructed. It seems to be built out of various hard doors and other pieces. It stretches about 8 or 9 feet high, but it looks like a wall that somebody has built. And you can see a group of 6 people carrying weapons walking toward you.
I told you. Trap.
From the wall.
Y'all have the fire ready?
Oh, God. Let's make some more cocktails.
All right, let's make... How many? Does everybody want one? We could really threaten them.
Ooh. Do we want to get the...
with my shotgun.
So we're all just readying weapons? Yeah.
Excuse me. Do you have time to answer some questions?
They call back and they say, "Who are you? Why are you here?"
Name's Lena 42. I'm with Sorrow University here conducting some research. Also, we're putting out some fires. A little bit of A, a little bit of B. Don't see any fires around, so that's a good sign. Don't have to worry about that. So now I just want to know if you got some experiences from Nightfall you'd like to share for some research.
Why are you on the Great Southern Highway?
We're traveling, headed towards academic utopia, Acutopia, as I've come to call it.
You know, family outing.
They're close enough that you can see faces, and they seem slightly confused by you.
I mean, erratic behavior is on my character sheet.
They haven't, like, aimed their weapons at you yet. They are armed. This is... You're entering Restoration Province here. If you intend to pass through, you must submit to search. This is the search station for Restoration Province.
Man, everybody's all handsy today.
And what are you looking for?
The same thing everyone is looking for.
Fire?
Love?
Money?
Research? Subjects who are compliant?
Fire starting apparatus, you...
Why are you so interested?
If you don't remember the fires, and you haven't seen all of the wild people out there still starting them, then I have concerns about your mental stability at the moment.
Hey, wait a minute. Are y'all part of the fire brigade?
We're part of Restoration Province.
Okay, we're part of the fire brigade, and we're in charge.
Not here, you're not.
So strip.
They don't strip.
I pull out my gun.
Suddenly,
I was about to ask if they were hostile.
Six now guns they are aimed in your direction, Shireen, and they say, "Drop it."
Damn it!
I go. Everybody, just calm down. What is restoration? What are y'all? What do you do? Are you trying to stop fires? Or are you trying to start fires?
Or are fires that you restore?
We are trying to eke out some semblance of normalcy in this topsy-turvy world.
So no through clear this wall, answer, huh?
Through this wall are people. Normal people trying to live out as normal a life as possible at this time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's great.
Well, that's exactly what we're looking for.
We're just trying to pass on through.
So I'm going to throw the question out there again. Are you trying to start fires or are you trying to stop fires?
We are trying to stop people
from
setting fires at random. We will not yeah. allow fire starting apparatus into Restoration Province.
Fine.
If you want to pass through, you need to leave your fire starting apparatus here at the search station.
We never found any anyway. I think we're still fresh out.
The fire brigade already took our fire starting apparatuses. So we don't have
any. Why would fire brigade take your apparatus? You wear their colors.
Well,
yeah, then they made us fire brigade.
Hey, and they still wouldn't give us back our lighters.
Are you looking for new members?
Yeah, because we have a very poor relationship with our current employers, and we're looking for a better tenure track.
We're just going to join all the anti-fire groups along the way.
Yeah, but I need to know about the benefits of this situation.
Three kerchiefs, two special hats, a pair of sunglasses.
Do you have a cooler color handkerchief?
All the swag.
About this time, another person is approaching and calls out and says, Lena? Is that Lena? Lena 42?
Yeah.
The one with the interesting theories on...
The very correct theories, I'll have you know, if you didn't see what all happened.
And the rest of you seem familiar. I think one of you is in administration somewhere.
No respect.
I know. It's like everyone thinks I'm like a department secretary. And I'm not.
It's okay, everybody. Everybody put your guns down.
Who is this person? Do I know them?
That depends. How familiar are you? Well, honestly, all of you would know who this person is because you've seen him in the news. This is BNA25, who was one of the assistant professors of astronomy who had postulated the existence of Palgash 2 and predicted the eclipse.
You're that guy with the moon theory.
Yeah, the theory that turned out to be true.
Well, let's wait until all the evidence is in.
I think there's plenty of evidence around here.
Has this been peer reviewed?
What are you all doing?
We're trying to get to Acutopia.
We were told that if we go this way, we're going to find it.
Acutopia? Are you talking about Amgondo?
Yeah. A place.
Yeah.
I mean, it's down the Great Southern Highway, and that is where everybody from the University Sanctuary went.
Mm-hmm.
What? I mean, you're... Sorry, words have failed me. we can definitely get you along your way towards Amgondo. You'll definitely have to leave any fire starting material here because the search stations that you pass along the way will not let you proceed with it, and you'll actually be in danger if you're found with it.
Mm-hmm.
Also, those guns probably need to stay here too. There's no way that you're going to make it to Amgondo with them.
I saw cannibals along the road. Have you not seen all the cannibals?
Yeah, we're keeping these.
Yeah, I'm not giving up my gun.
We found some cannibals who started a whole house fire and then they set a bulldozer on fire. It's terrible. Dangerous.
Yeah, there's crazy cannibals starting fires. We have to stop them.
Yeah, it was me.
That's horrifying.
You can understand.
Come inside, and I mean, you. I'm here and can vouch for you, so you can definitely keep your guns at this point. But you're not likely to be allowed through some of the other search stations with them. The next one up along the way is Six Suns, and after that is Godland, and Daylight after that. Honestly, they keep changing as people move on. If you haven't noticed, things have broken down quite a bit, and there are little fiefdoms popping up everywhere.
Y'all, we're going to look into that truck plan again.
Yeah.
Do you have any trucks we can borrow?
I don't think so. I think most of the trucks from Restoration Province area were pushed over the side of the highway to make room for living space.
Waste of a perfect.
So wait. This province just exists on the highway?
Well, yeah. I mean, this is the most defensible spot. As you move down the highway, you're going to pass through province after province. There are off-ramps here and there, but once you get down into the wilderness off the side, you run afoul of various wild men who are setting fires or attacking and being people, as it seems like you encountered some of them. It's just best to stay up here on the raised highway.
Interesting.
So what are the... How do some of these other provinces feel about sanctioned research?
I don't know.
Okay. Well, we'll cross that bridge when we come to it. Literally, maybe.
I really don't know a whole lot about the other provinces, but what I can do... Come inside. I'll see if Raista will get you something to eat. And we can all have a drink together. Those bottles of alcohol you have definitely look welcome. I think my whiskey is running dry.
Who said we're sharing?
Besides,
most of them are Molotovs.
Being willing to trade along the highway is going to be something you might want to consider. It might smooth your path. But what I can do, I am the professor here for Restoration Province. Basically, they keep me around to write diplomatically to their neighbors and help them with some of the more intellectual tasks that need to be done. Which is good, because we were... Honestly, I was headed to Mgondo myself with Raista, but she got hurt, and so we've stayed here. I can set you up with a pass. I don't know how long it will be honored, but I can try and give you something that will get you through maybe one or two more provinces without them confiscating weapons.
Oh, that would be great.
Be grateful.
So
yeah,
go ahead.
Oh, that I wasn't gonna say. I've got nothing.
Okay, it looked like you were gonna talk. So Bine writes out a pass for you and hands it to one of you, and you're all kind of sitting around chatting with Bine and Raista. Kind of, you have a moment of safety. Sit and think about what you've done, mm-hmm. and where you're headed to, what the world has become. Is there anything you all want to do before moving?
Look out and I go, y'all, things are a lot bleaker out here than I thought they would be. People really didn't do well in the dark.
Is that what caused all, like, why? I'm interested in your theories.
Yeah. So here it is.
A lot of PowerPoint.
Time for a lecture. Just drink it up.
Okay, so let's roll to see how convincing your lecture is.
I have one weird knowledge skill in biosentience.
It's gonna be an 8.
Each of you tell me how much give me a descriptive term for how difficult it would be to convince you that darkness was a living creature. To convince your character that darkness was a living creature.
Because I am spinning about why they need to out of a class, and they've used a lot of excuses.
Would it be possible at all, or would you consider it impossible?
I feel like it would be somewhat possible, but it would take a little bit of effort as a result of dealing with.
And Elsin?
I feel like Elsin could be convinced without an enormous amount of effort, considering cannibals are probably new.
You've never seen darkness before now, really, except for like every now and then, like in a cave or something.
Yes, caves do exist. People have been in them. They've been in darkness. There was an entire tunnel of mystery in the Jungler province that had an amusement park ride that had people spend 15 minutes in darkness. So it did cause people claustrophobia and agoraphobia. Had mental impact. But anyway. Shireen, how hard would it be to convince you that darkness was a living creature?
I think under normal circumstances, I probably would be pretty hard to convince, but after seeing the cannibals and the other weird stuff, I wouldn't be totally, like, unconvinced.
Okay. So, yeah, that does. Lena, the hardest difficulty is going to be a 6, which is an 18 target.
Yep.
So anything you want to add to lower difficulties, skills, assets, effort in delivering this lecture?
Yeah. So I have one weird knowledge skill in biosentience, which is my forte.
Okay.
I also have one.
-1.
I also have 3 books that I've written and were published about this topic that I can use as physical. I'm like, if you look here under these footnotes.
I will count those as physical assets, which will reduce it by 2, because you can reduce by 2 using assets. So that's a total of 3 that you've reduced.
I have fits of insight. I don't know if you want to count that one. The idea that at some points I'm very lucid.
I'm going to say no for this particular task.
That's fair. I'll just use some effort.
Do you have edge in intellect or
not? I don't
know.
It'd
be 3 points. Okay, so that is going to reduce the difficulty by 4, meaning your most difficult is going to be a target number of 6.
I rolled an 8. Barely got it.
Yeah, so the 3 of you are convinced by this lecture that there is merit to Lena's arguments.
So
I won't decide for you whether you actually believe that darkness is a sentient living creature, but there's something to Lena's arguments.
So listen, in this book that I wrote years ago, I posit that when darkness has the opportunity, it is going to take over the entire world, and that it likely has a tie to some other life force. I argue that's the stars we all saw, and that the darkness and being inside of it has some sort of draining effect, some sort of vampiric effect on human beings. And I think you all know that that's true, given what we experienced, the loss of sort of mental faculty, of where we were at, all this sort of stuff. It's gone from us because the darkness took it. It's some sort of like slumbering creature, like locusts or something, that hides out for extended periods of time, and it comes out once in a very long periods of time to feed, and once it's gathered, it goes back into hibernation.
So, how do we kill it?
That's my biggest thought too.
That's a great question. So it seems concerned about light, from what we can tell. If you make a place where it is difficult for light to get, the darkness will go there. Now, of course, light is the standard function of the entire universe. There is light everywhere. Things are always lit. Darkness comes in and takes that light. They seem to be at odds with each other, so there's a tie there, and I mean, I think we're on the cusp of some cutting-edge research, so if we can find the answer to that, we're going to be heroes.
I'm going to shoot it next time.
You should try.
You're going to shoot the dark?
I've shot into the darkness a few times just as... I'm gonna, not going to lie. It wasn't my most scientific moment, but I was just throwing science at the wall. See what happened.
Yep.
But, I mean, you're a better shot than me.
I'm going to attack the darkness.
You're a better shot than me, so you should give it a shot.
So do you think the fires have something to do with this?
Because
fires bring light.
They do bring light. And so here's the interesting thing. And it's
about that time, somebody comes and knocks on the door and hands Bina a message.
I go, it's shadows. It's the thing we got to figure out. I'll just say that. We can talk more on the road.
And Bina reads the message, and a moment later he's like, well, shit. You all need to move along now, and you need to go quickly. The apostles have raised an army, and they're headed this
way. I don't know who that is, but are they for or against fires?
The Apostles of Flame, the cult.
Oh, okay, those guys. They're for fire, yeah.
Yeah, they're...
Take the little green handkerchief off and...
You might want to keep that on at least for a little while until this note quits working. Mm. But you all should move along towards Six Suns now, and hopefully you can make it to Amgondo before the Apostles... Somebody needs to warn them. The apostles are heading there to try and wipe out the organization of government that's being created there. They want to have complete control over the entire planet.
That, like, through this place? Are you just going to sit here and get murdered?
I can't leave. Raista's still too hurt to travel. We'll make do. Most of the vehicles here don't work. You're not going to find a lot of motorized transport along the road. You will find cleared road, thankfully.
Oh.
We'll find a way, but you should head out and try to get to Amgondo before the apostles so that you can warn them.
Oh.
All right.
It was good seeing you again. I will spread the word. I'll let people know what happened to you here. And, you know, I just want to say I always thought your theories were garbage, but you were a good person, and I appreciate that.
Nim's going to hit their head.
Likewise.
That's fair. Head out now.
I'm going to, on my way out, I'm going to tell Bina, was it?
Bina, yeah.
I'm going to thank... Much higher ratings.
Oh my god.
Alright. So, are you moving along?
Yep.
Ready to go.
Okay.
Don't gotta tell me twice.
The apostles of fire sound dangerous.
You pack up your meager belongings, what little food that they can spare for you for your trip. You've got your note from Bina, and you head off through Restoration Province. You make good time. They've done a good job of clearing the highway. There's basically the center of the highway is open for travel, and they've got various tents and other, like, living situations set up, whether that be in the remains of an old shipping truck or some tarpaulins that have been raised up over some car doors. They've got various living situations around. But all up here on the raised highway there, where they're in relative safety. And you travel along. It's about 7 or 8 miles before you approach the end of Restoration Province. And at the other end of Restoration Province, they let you through their search barricade there. And you are presented with an open stretch of highway and another search barricade on the other side, about a mile down the road. as you approach the search station for six suns, a couple of shots ricochet off the highway near you. It seems like they're possibly warning shots. There are people pointing weapons at you, telling you, state your business!
I elbow Elsa and I go, hey, that's your thing.
I don't like being on this end of it. Who's got that note?
I show them the note. We have a hall pass!
What's it say?
It says...
It says, to whom it may concern, this is to attest that the bearers of this document, Elsid 23, Lena 42, Nim 28, and Shireen 96, are properly accredited emissaries of the Fire Patrol of Cerro City, and that they are entitled to free passage through the checkpoints on the way to Amgondo National Park.
Man, he could write.
That's what it says.
Fire Patrol, Fire Patrol. And the guy next to him nudges him. Oh, that's, oh, shoot. I have lost my names. That's
so-and-so's thing.
Yeah, that's so-and-so's thing. Altanol's group. Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I remember. Well, I guess... I guess that's good, but don't let us find you here in Six Suns again. And they let you pass through the barricade and proceed on through Six Suns.
Okay.
A friendly joke.
Yeah, so y'all...
By the way, the Apostles of Fire are coming.
BT dubs.
They look at you suspiciously like, what are you talking about? They're from the before times.
Oh, no, they are in the after times, too.
They are everywhere.
So,
take it by y'all's response that you're not willing to sign up. Okay, it's
what
fine.
The
we'll
heck
be on.
Is
see
that?
I pull Lena, and we just keep walking.
I go. This my research is really difficult now.
So, Six Suns Province is somewhat similar to Restoration Province. It's got various people. It's a little rougher people. Not quite as civilized, but still, you know, make and do. Makeshift structures. There are some people along here who've got various like food stuffs, like the equivalent of like carrots and potatoes and stuff like that, that you could trade for with some of your alcohol or your bullets, if you needed some. And your food that you had is running low. That you basically got a day's worth of MREs from Altanol and maybe a day's worth of food at Restoration Province, so stocking up wouldn't be a bad idea, and they seem willing to trade. They're just gonna haggle with you for bullets or booze.
Eh, sure, why not? I could spare 20 rounds.
I'll throw in 20 rounds.
Alright, who wants to lead the negotiation? And we'll have it be a roll. It'll be an intellect roll.
Me. I have fast talk.
Okay. So it's really about getting a good deal. So I'm just going to say this is... We'll start at a difficulty 3. So a target of 9. What does fast talk do for you?
Speaking to an intelligent creature who can understand you and isn't hostile.
They're not hostile.
I can convince the creature to take one reasonable action, which is to give me a good deal on this.
Okay,
trade.
Then honestly, with that ability, is it an enabler, or is there a point spend?
It's a one intellect.
Yeah, so spend your intellect point and you won't have to roll at all. Yeah, they give you a good deal. You get a nice sack of carrots and potatoes, and they even throw in like a couple of dead rabbits. That seem very fresh, and you pass over the 40 bullets, and you've got food enough to where you could make a rabbit stew and have food for the four of you for a number of days.
Sounds good.
Okay, y'all, something occurs to me just now, the bandana and stuff. I think we might have accidentally joined a gang.
I mean, it's helped us so far, so. Yes.
I think the goal now is to join as many gangs as possible.
I mean, what are their rules for joining? Is it just wear a nice piece of clothing?
Well, we got hazed. Yeah, so, you know.
They shot at us.
Yeah. We were told to start. Wait, I'm still not clear about this. We were told to start a fire or told.
I think it's something, contextual.
Okay.
Something about fires and that if we didn't do it, they would find us.
Yeah, yes. Okay, so there,
that's why we stopped the bad cannibals, because they had fire on
them. There's
a
punishment element here, okay.
If someone's setting a fire, I think we're supposed to set them on fire.
Yeah, that's right.
Gangs are complicated.
You all were very dazzled by the stars, apparently. Anyway, you proceed on through Six Suns. You manage to get to Godland. You arrive at Godland, and they will not let you take guns through. You can keep your ammo, because that's money. But they will not let you pass through Godland with guns.
Did you see our badge, though?
You have your pass, and you have your fire patrol neckerchiefs. The man you're speaking to, Harim 654, says absolutely not. You cannot come through Godland with guns.
Why is that?
You will leave them here. We do not allow guns in Godland.
But why?
Wait, do they have guns?
They do. They're outside Godland. They're at the search station.
Semantics.
I go, can you just like give us a patrol, like you lead us through to make sure we don't do anything bad?
No, we do not allow guns in Godland.
Under what circumstances?
On the outskirts of Godland.
Do you allow guns?
None.
So like, what do you do when you go inside? You just leave your guns here?
Yes.
Like laying on the ground?
No, the next watch takes them.
Are you going to make us take off our clothes?
Why would we do something like that?
Everybody else asks us that.
Okay, so I'm going to turn around and hide my gun in my shirt. Close my jacket.
I'm trained in lies and trickery. I'll help.
I'm also trained in deception. Right. I don't have a gun.
So this is going to be a speed roll to try and hide the gun without them seeing. It's gonna be challenging. They are okay. Alert for guns, and they've been chatting with you already. So the challenging is a difficulty 5, so target of 15.
Okay, I have deception as a skill.
Okay.
And sneaking.
Okay.
As a skill. So, how does that...
That'll drop you to a difficulty 3 with a target of 9.
Was Elsid helping by, like, stepping in front and asking a question, like, at right...
lies and tricky. Yeah. What's the caliber of the weapons that you all are using? I'm very excited by that.
That's what do you classify
fine.
As a gun?
So that'll drop it to a difficulty 2.
I'm scared, so I'm gonna put a little effort in.
Okay, so this is a speed task, so if you've got edge, it costs 2 points, and if you don't, then it costs 3 points.
Okay. I don't have edge. Alright. Now I'm rolling. 16!
Nice. Yeah, you managed to secrete your gun away, so that they do not know that you have it. But they insist on taking the guns from the other three of you.
Now, could I do a player intrusion?
Yeah.
So one of mine is old friend.
So do you have an experience point to spend for the player intrusion?
I have 2 points, so yeah. I'll spend one of those.
Yeah, spend the experience point, and so you, one of the guards here with, working for Harem 654 is an old friend of yours named Geldrax 41.
Geldrax, old buddy. Whose name I totally knew.
Galdrax, is that you?
So, yeah, Galdrax is a friend of yours, and he is there.
Buddy, we go way back. Can't you help a guy out? We're not going to stay in your place. We're basically fleeing south. I have these weirdo academics. You remember that job, right? After the last one, I decided to go to the university. Didn't work out super well. Stuck with them. Can you help me get past with them?
El Cid, I haven't seen you in years. I think it's been since, like, high school? Was it high school?
Probably. That didn't go well for me either, but, you know.
Harem, I trust him. I think we can let them through, but I understand, Harem. I understand that you're not going to want the guns there. What if they hand over the guns, one of us takes the guns to the other side and gives them back on the other side? I think that would work. Nobody needs to know that the guns are in Godland. And so with a few minutes of talking, explaining his relationship to you, how you both knew each other from, like, you played at daycare known each other since you were babies. Convinces Harem to let you go through with the guns. You just have to hand them over here, and they will give them back to you on the other side of Godland.
Sounds good.
Yeah, sure.
Mine is still hidden.
Yeah, you hid yours. So they collect the guns from the other three of you and provide you with an escort. Galdrax will escort you to the other side of Godland, which is about 50 miles down the highway, and we'll give back your guns on the other side.
Cool.
Nice. Good to know people.
A helpful friend.
That was an excellent player intrusion.
Also, I love how it's called friend.
All right, so you proceed through Godland, and as you're moving along, you can see there is this vast settlement of people down below the highway. It seems like makeshift tents down there as well. They have many fires burning. It's unclear what state of lawfulness exists down there, but it seems much more chaotic than the organized groups that you've encountered here on the highway. And then as you're nearing the end of Godland province, there you can see off in the distance a convoy of military vehicles that are headed in the direction of Mgondo. They're near enough to the highway that probably at the next overpass they'll be able to, or next on-ramp, they could pull up onto the highway. That might be where they're going. The symbology on the vehicles is the Apostles of Flame.
Oh, those are the people we're supposed to set on fire, I think.
We need more Molotovs.
We still have some booze.
Are they within throwing distance?
No.
Dang. Alright,
so you reach the edge of Godland. You know that time is running out. The apostles are getting near. You pass through the gate into Daylight Province. The roads here are clear, and for the right price, you could even get a car. They have multiple cars available here at the edge of the province. They have the little single-seaters that you had before. They've also got a couple of multi-seat cars. nothing like the military vehicles that the apostles have, but conveyance is possible.
Said some vans, are they?
I said conveyance is possible. So, I mean, if you want a van, there's probably something roughly equivalent to that.
We need something that looks like we mean business.
Like a bulldozer.
They don't have a bulldozer.
They have a big truck.
Yeah, probably like a large pickup truck, probably something like that.
Okay. What do we need to accrue this vehicle?
What do you got?
Or acquire this vehicle.
What do you got? You're there's a person here who's minding the vehicles named Nibular 81. And Nibular 81 has a number of vehicles available for the right price.
Who's good at persuasion?
Him is. Perfect. What would you...
We deal in all of the regular currencies. Ammunition, alcohol, food, and other pleasures.
What I'm a record player.
let's just say options include things that I'm not going to say on stream. So, but things that get more into the NC-17 rating area that I would rather not go into.
Okay. All right, Nim, we've got 7 bottles of liquor. I need at least 2 to get the rest away to the province. So you've got 5 to work with.
Got 5 to work with. I still have... I can part ways. And
I've got 78 rounds on me. If we had to, I could part with another 20.
Wow.
So what would you say going price for this rusty old bucket?
It's actually a very nice vehicle that you are looking at. Barely any damage from the crash. It seems like the person driving it just got out and stepped out of the door while it was moving. So it barely nudged the barrier on the edge of the highway. Almost pristine condition, and the fuel cells are fully charged. So I would say this car that you are looking at, with the carrying capacity in the back, seating for 4, it even has temperature controls.
Yeah.
This is going to run you approximately 300 ammunition.
Hmm. What?
Or a mixture of ammunition and alcohol, or other things that you might want to offer.
What's your poison when it comes to alcohol?
Oh, we take just about anything.
And what would you say a comparable mixture of alcohol would be? You know, the two ways.
So, currency-wise, I would say you can substitute up to 40 ammunition with a bottle of alcohol. Yes.
But this is clearly not your most expensive thing on the lot.
That gives us
Indeed not. If you wish to see the most expensive item that we do have this propeller car here. And what he takes you over to is it can best be described as a small aircraft. It is a car roughly in the shape of, let's say, the little flying cars in the Jetsons, with a propeller on the front. And once you get up to high enough speed, you can start the propeller going, and it will actually pull you forward. It doesn't fly per se, but it will travel at very fast speeds. It can cover probably 3 or 4 times the speed that an Earth car could get up to.
How much is that one?
Oh, this one here, again, this is in very, very fine condition. I would say this one is going to run you 600 or 700 ammunition.
Nobody's got that kind of money around here. You'll never sell
especially
that vehicle.
Especially for something that just looks like a boat meeting a car.
It doesn't even fly.
This is one of the elite cars of like, this is top of the line. This is like getting a Tesla, or I mean, honestly, not going to go into whether that's a good company or not. Their cars are highly sought after. If you want to negotiate the price down, you can try to do so, but the price that is set as the initial opening offer from the car salesman is 600 or 700 ammunition.
Hey, well, what's down the road from here? How do we know we're not going to drive this, like, you know, 300 feet and somebody on your side is going to stop us and confiscate our car, or you're going to put up some sort of barrier for us? Is it straight shot all the way to Uganda or wherever we're going?
Uganda.
We're going to Acutopia.
Daylight Province is open from here until Light of the Sun's Province, and there is car travel allowed between the two provinces. After Light of the Suns is Civilization Rises, and after that is Umgondo National Park. From here on, the highway is mostly cleared, and you just have to pass through the checkpoints.
So what you're saying is you're not going to offer us insurance if we make a purchase today that guarantees travel and roadside service?
Oh, absolutely no insurance.
Taillight warranty.
Where do you think we are, in the before times? I'm out to get as much as I can to help my family and I survive.
But we're four people trying to survive as well and spread an important
thing. I have salvaged these vehicles. I have ensured that they work. I have ensured that they have fuel cells charged up and can get you where you're going. I charge a price for it. I'm willing to negotiate.
Do you see that brigade up there?
Indeed.
We are trying to stop the brigade.
They have a number of operational vehicles. Perhaps you want to go negotiate with them.
No. They're going to come and kill you unless we stop them.
They
so if you
do not appear
give
to be headed
car,
towards my location here.
It's only a matter of time.
Quietly drag Shireen back a little bit.
Just a little bit.
So do you want a counteroffer, or do you want to figure out how to pay 600 or 700 ammunition?
I'm going to look at my group. Which are we feeling? I know we saw the propeller car, and I saw Shireen's eyes light up a little bit, which I haven't seen since the fire.
I mean, I only have 49 rounds of ammunition, so I don't really have much in the way of offering for...
And it's 40 ammo per liquor bottle,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, so I think...
Yeah. Unless you want to negotiate that, too. Everything's negotiable.
Have you tried Fireball before? It is the best of the best, top-of-the-line type of alcohol. You are never going to find
this. Do we want to go for the propeller or we want to go for the big truck?
I mean, what are our odds like that we'll actually get the propeller? Like, could we do it? Because if
we
could.
Try.
This sort of seems like a quick way to die horribly.
The propeller?
Yes.
It is a...
What's the mid-range
for the average happy family?
It's a fun question for the DM. Who all's around here? Is it just this guy?
No, there are other people. There are other like people that have settled near the border of Godland and Daylight. So if you wanted to be around talking to people about their experience of darkness and stars, you're welcome to do so. Or if you had some other idea.
I know. I'd be honest, from a metagame perspective, I was trying to figure out how hard it would be to just steal this from this guy.
Oh,
and
oh no, no.
I was just going to say
there are people.
Dang.
Okay.
But could they be easily run over by a truck? How many people are going to jump out in front of a truck before they go get out of the way?
I mean, I still have my chainsaw, so we could also just attach it to the car, so I don't think anyone's going to stop it.
You could also offer any of those tools up as part of the bargain. You had asked about trading, swapping out alcohol for ammunition, but you have a trunk, you have a bag or a bunch of like tools.
All right.
We might have to get rid of the chainsaw.
Blasphemy.
Wait, weren't there two chains?
There was a table saw. Which, you know, that might be more useful actually to him than a chainsaw.
Yeah, the chainsaw and a circular saw and a leaf blower.
Two saws for the propeller car.
You're really not wanting to give up this alcohol. All right.
Two saws will knock off 200 ammunition.
I'm also I also want to use demeanor command to kind of convince him that he's getting a really good deal out of it and that this is actually worth it.
Okay.
These chainsaws cut their way here.
Do you think we got through all this mess without cutting a few things down? I'm not going to say what those things are. What helped us with that?
You could increase the value of your cars by adding a chainsaw.
I would like to land, what is it called, from like Jeopardy, Vanna White, the chainsaw.
Oh, that's right. Oh, that's right. You do the Vanna White thing.
Yeah.
Shireen and I will sit in front of the trunk and be like,
all right, so it's 2 intellect points to use your demeanor of command. That gives you a free level of effort on a persuasion task. So, what do you want your final offer to be, and we'll roll for it.
Okay, so we're doing two chainsaws. Is this correct?
I mean, you might throw in a couple bottles of alcohol.
He countered that the two chainsaws would knock off 200 ammunition.
And the total was 300, is that correct?
For the propeller car, it's 600.
All right. Truck. Doing math.
So we're also offering 3 bottles of top-tier Fireball.
Which he had set the price at 40. I will let you do 50 each for the Fireball. All
right.
And let
top
you say
tier.
That there are 3 bottles of that.
We're at 250.
So that would be
350.
Well, 350. Oh. The two saws and the 3 bottles of alcohol would be 350, equivalent to 350. So that leaves you with 250 ammunition. You can counter to say that you'll offer less than that, and we'll roll and see what you come up with, or you can come up with the 250 ammunition and buy the car at the price set.
Let's roll.
I say toss in one more bottle of liquor, make it 4 bottles, and then roll for it.
Okay, this last bottle is only going to be worth 40, though, not 50 like the 3.
What if the last bottle is vodka?
Top tier. No, because everything, if you remember from the beginning, I said it was all bottom rail. No. I'm letting you have 3 bottles of Fireball and counting those as extra, but anything else would be 40.
Okay. All right. Oh, question. Could I combine Demeanor Command with Fast Talk?
What does Fast Talk do?
Speaking to an intelligent creature who can understand you and isn't hostile, I can convince the creature to take one reasonable action. I would like to use that as a persuasion to think that the price I'm about to suggest when I'm offering.
Tell you what, you spend the intellect point, I will count it as easing the task so that it will drop by 1 difficulty. With that, so total between the two abilities, you would be spending 3 intellect points. You'll still have to roll, but the fast talk will ease it by 1.
Okay.
So, are we ready to roll?
I can throw in my record player if he's genuinely interested in it. I wasn't joking about that. I do actually have a record player.
we'll see if it becomes necessary. Okay. So where are we at as a number? What are you offering?
Did you decide to throw in that last bottle? Because that would be 10. Is that correct?
390.
It'd be 390, and then that leaves you needing 210 ammunition.
Sounds right.
So let's just offer 390 as the price. No ammunition.
Okay. That is going to be significantly harder than if you add some ammunition to the offer.
I mean, I'll put in 10 ammunition. I don't
have
that many.
I can drop another 10.
A shotgun, so I don't carry that much to begin.
Okay, so
that'd be 410 total that you're offering against a price of 600.
Yeah.
Okay. That is somewhat difficult. I'm gonna say that is gonna be intimidating as far as the level of challenge in order to convince this person to part with this very, very high quality car in these hard, hard times. So that puts the difficulty at 6 with a target number of 18. You already identified a couple of things. You're eased by 1 for using fast talk. And then I've already forgotten.
Right.
Yep. And then
free level of effort.
Yeah.
Right? So that will drop it to difficulty 4. You can spend additional effort, or if you have any other... Well... Yeah, no, we've already factored in all of the items. If you wanted to throw in the record player, I'll count it as an asset.
Sure.
I would also like to throw in my...
Okay, how does that work?
It's just adds 1 to intellect edge for one hour after being active. Am I allowed to use edge?
So if it adds 1 to your edge, it reduces the point cost to use effort, is what edge does.
Oh, okay.
So did you already have intellect edge?
Mm-hmm.
And this would add an additional edge. So you'd have 2 edge, and it would only cost you 1 point to use a level of effort.
I would like to.
Okay. And you're throwing in the record player?
Yep.
So that, with all of that combined, we'll say it is a difficulty 2, so you need to beat a 6 to make this deal happen for that price.
I can do it. This is the time where I really fail. 17.
Yeah. So happily accepts the 4 bottles of alcohol, the 2 saws, and the record player, along with a couple 30 rounds of ammunition, I believe it was, hands over the keys to the propeller car and says, "You're really going to like this," and pats the car and says, it kind of looks longingly at it. Says, "Wonderful, wonderful car. So sorry to see you go." And just has a moment of sorrow parting with this glorious piece of technology that he managed to salvage from the wreckage of this highway.
Don't worry. Odds are we won't light it on fire.
I say, would you say that your strange affinity for cars started after Nightfall, or would you say it was before Nightfall?
I've been a used car salesman for about 7 years.
Did you often talk to them longingly, as if they were a person?
Cars are living creature.
Okay.
So is darkness, turns out. Funny story.
All right.
And he gets a look of horror on his face. Yeah, you pile into the propeller car.
Oh, we're going to die.
Rev it up, and you can zoom down this highway now. There is an open lane in the middle. People are expecting drivers. You manage to zip through Daylight Province very quickly. It turns out the next province is actually called Onos. Rudimentary inspection at the border. You hid your guns in the car so they didn't see them. You make it through. You pass through Onos and Light of the Suns, and civilization rises, arriving at Umgondo National Park, well ahead of the military convoy of the Apostles of Flame. And there is a sprawling settlement. If you've ever seen movies where groups have traveled to settle on another planet or something, and kind of kind of temporary buildings that get set up with tarps and kind of a central command structure with like housing off to the sides. It's kind of like that, where they're in the middle of this wilderness that wasn't burned because people didn't live here. And they've set up a makeshift organizational center where they can start rebuilding the world from the ashes of the former world. And yeah, you arrive there, people there recognize you and your affiliation to the university. They welcome you in, and you begin your new lives as settlers. Do you tell them of the approaching army of the Apostles of Flame?
Yeah, definitely.
Tell them about that, and also tell them about my new theories that I just came up with.
They definitely thank you for the warning, and the leaders of the camp head off to start planning response to an oncoming army of military vehicles under the banner of the Apostles of Flame. They seem less enthusiastic about Lena's new theories, but they've dealt with Lena, and she doesn't seem any less sane than she was before Nightfall, so they let it pass. There is more in the book as far as an end to this story, but this is where we're going to leave the game. You all managed to come through from the wreckage of Saro City all the way to the burgeoning new civilization out here in Amgondo National Park. I think you all dealt very well with the dogs especially, and the fine young cannibals, and the other encounters along the way.
We made it through with zero moral ambiguity at all. Nothing at all that we might have nightmares about
and
forever.
And we got a cool car.
Smooth sailing.
So, I hope you all enjoyed. And I, just out of curiosity, I don't think any of you had ever played the Cypher system before.
I had not.
Mm-mm. What did you all think?
I think I like it. It's feels like it gives more room for narrative.
It is definitely a narrative-focused system.
When I was reading through the rule book, I was like, this seems really complicated and like convoluted. But playing it, I was like, it's not that complicated. It just seems that way going into it, I think, was my impression.
It's actually quite a bit less rolling than... The only other thing I'm familiar with is D&D 5th.
Yeah.
And then 3.5, which was like playing a spreadsheet.
It's all about the calculation of how can you reduce the difficulty on this and make it possible to do.
It felt in some ways easier to play.
We will, I agree. We will dive more into discussion of Nightfall, the work, and how this game related to it, as well as we can talk more about the Cypher system and what your thoughts were on it when we do roll call on an upcoming Thursday. I don't know the actual date. I don't believe it is next week, but
it's not next week. It's definitely not next week. It would probably be 3 weeks from now.
Okay, so
just let us know.
Upcoming on roll call, we will have a discussion of this, so watch for that. Likely 3 weeks from now on Thursday.
In a week, it'll be Dante's Inferno.
Yes. So coming up next week on Thursday is roll call for Dante's Inferno, and then 2 weeks from today on April 23rd. At the same time slot, 6 p.m. on Friday, for the role of play, we will have a one-shot honey heist adventure led by Kira Dietz based on The Hobbit. So stop by for that. And then I believe after that we have another one-shot based on the adventures of Sherlock Holmes coming up 2 weeks after that. So watch for those. If you are at all interested in becoming involved with this stream, we are interested in having players or game masters who are interested in joining one-shot games. learning new systems, whatever, playing on this show. If you are a Virginia Tech student, staff, or faculty, if you're a community member here in the Blacksburg area, or if you happen to be involved with libraries as our guests today, you can fill out a form. The link will be in chat to get in touch with us so that we can invite you for future games on the Role of Play. I was going to do one last round, let you all remind everybody who you are, what you do, and if you've got any special projects that they should be looking out for, please share them. And I now have just your character names in front of me, so I'm going to call you by those. And we'll start with Shireen, which I believe is Lara.
Yes. Hi, everyone. I'm Lara Fountaine. I'm the Student Success and Engagement Librarian at NC State University. This is my cat, Noctis. Something fun coming up that I have going on is on the library. We also, the NC State University Libraries, also has a Twitch. And on our Twitch channel, I will be doing a Sims stream on, I think, May 5th around lunchtime. I did a previous stream where I built Hunt Library, which is a library that we're one of our libraries that we're known for. And so this next stream will be spent furnishing the library. So I will be doing that May 5th during lunch.
Cat has an amazing name.
Okay, and I have actual names in front of me now instead of character names. So, Malaka.
So my name's Malaka Friedman, and I am the graduate extension student for the Hill Makerspace. I'm also a PhD student. And yeah, just reiterating, the Twitch channel, we have lots of cool upcoming things that are happening of Makerspace students going to different technologies of 3D printers, digital embroiderers, sewing machines, sticker machines, all sorts of fun things that you can check out. We also have on Wednesday, April 28th, and I believe also Friday the 30th, we have Follow Your Streams, where we have graduate students play video games and comment them in a very academic way as they're playing. So things like playing Mario Kart and talking about energy.
Sean.
So I'm Shaun Bennett, Research Librarian for Business, Education, and Data Literacy at State. And I'll just reiterate that the Twitch stream that they've got going at State is really great. And also we have a really cool documentary screening coming up on the weekend of April 15th. It's entirely online. It's through Vimeo. You can register on the library site. It's for The Biggest Little Farm, which is that really great documentary about folks starting a farm out for, you know, Sustainability Month. So if you want to watch a cool video with us, it's open to the public. You can just register on our site.
Jonathan?
I'm Jonathan Bradley. I'm head of studios and innovative technologies at Virginia Tech. I will be involved with the role of roll call, and I think I'll be here again over and over, I guess. We are still planning our summer programming and figuring out the logistics of that, so stay tuned for some news about that. But yeah. Keep joining us. And check out NC State's Twitch channel. It's great.
And I am your GM for the evening. I'm Anthony Wright Day Hernandez, the Community Collections Archivist here at Virginia Tech. As I mentioned at the top of the stream, I do host a show here every Wednesday at 2:30 p.m. I dual host it both on the VTUL Studios Twitch channel and my personal Twitch channel, Rogan27. So whether you know me from here or there, Archival Adventures Wednesdays at 2:30 p.m., where I share items from special collections and university archives at Virginia Tech. I think that is going to be the end of our show for today. Thank you all for joining us, and I hope that we see you again next time.
Thanks.
I forgot. Are we raiding someone?
I don't know. Probably.
One second.
Who's doing stuff right now?
I think.
Yeah.
It's possible, I suppose. Do. Bear with us. We really want you to come and raid with us. Oh, here, let's do this one. Send it to you now. This is a role-playing... it's a new channel play with a new group playing tabletop role-playing games. They are called The In Crowd, I-N-N. And they've got a great cast, and they should be live Fridays at 6 p.m., Pacific time, so they should be live now. Bye!